Here we go.
Have my signal. Unleash hell.
God bless the geek.
Rules. We don't think so.
Welcome to the Geek Speak Show.
Please make a note of it.
This is the show where you hear everything geek culture.
Have you noticed we've been sharing our culture with you all morning?
Talking movies, comics, video games, TV shows, all from a geek point of view. People who get it, get it. If it's geek, we'll speak about it.
Here on the Geek Speak Show. Here are your hosts, Henry and Romo.
Hello, everybody. Hey, you're not Romo.
I'm not Romo.
It's a good thing. You look better than Romo.
I should look better than Romo.
I hope you do. I hope I do. Anyway, hey, everybody. Welcome to the Geek Speak Show. So, yes, part two. Ready to warm up for WonderCon again?
Yes.
Not stretching. We're not going to lead you in stretching exercise or anything like that. Although, you might need it because those of you who've been to WonderCon and Comic Cons especially, you know, it's a lot of walking, a lot of, for us, carrying backpacks with all the free swag that we get from all the movies, the posters, all this stuff.
It's just too much.
You ready for that?
I am.
We've talked about this before. This is going to be your first ever convention.
Uh-huh.
And usually, we would start with Comic Con. But that would be like, you know, taking a kid out of high school football and put him in the starting lineup in the Super Bowl. So we're going to start slow. We're going to put you at WonderCon. It's a little smaller than it's big, but not as huge as Comic-Con.
Not as crazy.
Don't know. It's a new place.
That's
Anaheim.
True.
Not in San Francisco this year. Stop complaining. Yes, we know it will come back. We'll talk to David Glanzer. It's not WonderCon without our annual visit with David Glanzer, so he'll come on in a few minutes, and yes, we will address whether they come back, whether they're coming back
or not.
Are they? I actually don't know the answer.
Well, why are you teasing everyone then?
Because that's good radio. That's a tease right there, and stay tuned. We will talk about that. We're also going to hear from Jeph Loeb. He's been on before. Fan favorite Jeph Loeb from Marvel. Actually, I was going to say Marvel Comics, but he's actually the head of Marvel Television. He's going to talk about Spider-Man.
Oh, wow.
Not the reboot, but the spectacular Spider-Man, the new series coming to Disney XD, and some other surprises that he may tease about, as Jeph does whenever he comes on. Mr. Diablo, somebody else who's been on. A lot of old friends we're going to see at WonderCon. They're going to be on the show today. Scott Marcano, Mr. Diablo. He lives in LA, so it's right there for him this time. And also,
yes,
Rod Roddenberry.
That's exciting.
Yes. And she's looking at me like, who's Rod Roddenberry? No, Rod Roddenberry is the son of Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Gene no longer with us. His mom actually no longer with us either. But Rod, he's not in charge of Star Trek. It's still under CBS, Paramount. But he's the CEO of Roddenberry Entertainment, and he's going to talk to us. He has a panel, actually, on Sunday. Mm-hmm. We'll drop by and say hello. Somebody else who we talk to a lot on the phone all the time, but we've never actually met in person. So we're going to meet them in person for the first time. I hope he doesn't run away and is like, that's what you really look like. Don't want to talk to you guys anymore. But no, he's not like that. Rod is a very nice guy. So we'll hear from all of them. Who will just sit right there and enjoy this show. You're gonna have a if you're not going to WonderCon after you're done listening to the show, it'll feel like you were there at WonderCon. We'll put it that way. Another big announcement.
Yes.
No, not that. But another big announcement is we have a new home.
We have a new home,
and we're not even married. No, our new home is pknradio.com. It's a brand new internet talk station, not music, talk station, and it doesn't talk politics. Nobody on there talks about politics except to make fun of it. but you will hear us, our show's new episodes, every Thursday at 8 a.m. Pacific time, 11 a.m. Eastern time. So go to pknradio.com, and yes, you see that big banner on our website. Just click on it. It'll be on there. You'll also get a replay, when is it? At midnight, actually, Eastern, which is 9 p.m. our time. So if you miss it, it's right there. Plus, we'll still be on the Geek Speak Show website. You can just download it on there. But our new home is pknradio.com. It's been raining a lot here in San Francisco. Hope you don't have a leaky roof. It's what you call a fixer-upper. So there you go. That's one big announcement. The other one is, I was actually going to do this a couple of weekends ago, A couple of weekends ago, first weekend in March, as a matter of fact, we lost a legend, an icon for Star Wars fans, Ralph McQuarrie. He was the original concept artist, meaning the, you know what a concept artist is, right?
Yes.
Or no? Well, let me put you on the spot then. What is a concept artist? Good question. Concept artist is, he drew, I mean, George Lucas, obviously, we know he created Star Wars. Yes. It came from his imagination. But he went to Ralph McQuarrie and said, hey, I'm thinking of an alien that looks like this and does this and does that. He drew it. I'm thinking of a planet that looks this and has this. He actually drew this. He drew a bunch of the characters, Star Wars. Mm-hmm. I mean, not Star Wars. Darth Vader, 3PO. Who are some of the characters? You can look at the, you can cheat, look at the poster right in front of us. He actually drew the ships also. So pretty much everything that you see, that you saw in the original trilogies came from Ralph McQuarrie's hand. I was going to say his mind, but actually his hand. His pens, his inks, all that stuff. Now, he passed away, Ralph McQuarrie. He passed away on March 3rd. And we were going to do a memorial for him here on the show, but... Mm-hmm. You also know the, do you know who the name Doug Chiang is? Does that ring any names, any bells for you? I mean,
no bells are ringing.
Well, yeah, everybody else out there getting excited. But Doug Chiang basically is the Ralph McQuarrie for the prequel trilogy.
Uh-huh.
He did what Ralph McQuarrie did. He drew Jar Jar Binks, but if you don't tell anybody, I won't either. And the rest of the ships and the planets and all the stuff that you saw in the prequels.
Yeah.
Doug Chiang was the one in charge of doing that. He actually lives here in the Bay Area, and we've been in contact, and he's a little busy, as you can imagine, and so mm-hmm. are we, getting ready for WonderCon. But I was going to have him come on the show and have him, you know, talk to us about Ralph McQuarrie, because yeah. he did meet him. He was a very big inspiration, not only for Doug, but for a lot of artists of that work in this. But he just doesn't have time. But he was nice enough to answer a few questions via email, and he gave me the okay to share his thoughts with you guys. So, 2 weeks late, I know, yes, but... better late than never, as the saying goes. So here we're going to do a little tribute to Ralph McQuarrie now. Then I'll share Doug Chiang's thoughts with you guys right after this. And then we'll warm up for WonderCon.
Ralph Angus McQuarrie was born on June 13th, 1929 in Gary, Indiana. He spent his growing years on a farm in Billings, Montana. McQuarrie served in the U.S. Army during the Korean War, survived the shot to the head, and returned stateside and moved to California in 1960. While studying at the Art Center School in Los Angeles, he began working at a dentistry firm, drawing teeth and equipment. Later, he worked as a technical illustrator for Boeing. He designed film posters and animated CBS News' coverage of the Apollo space program at the three-man company, Real 3. While there, Ralph was asked by Hal Barwood to produce some illustrations for Star Dancing, a film project that Barwood and his writing partner Matthew Robbins were working on. It was never filmed, but Ralph McQuarrie's work on Star Dancing caught the eye of an old schoolmate of Hal Barwood's, George Lucas. Lucas met with Ralph McQuarrie to discuss plans for a space fantasy movie that Lucas was in the process of writing. In 1975, Lucas commissioned McQuarrie to illustrate several scenes from his script for The Star Wars. McQuarrie designed many of the film's characters, including R2-D2, C-3PO, Chewbacca, and Darth Vader, and drew concepts for the film's sets. It was Ralph McQuarrie who suggested that Darth Vader wear a breathing apparatus to help the character breathe in outer space. It was also Ralph McQuarrie's concept painting of R2-D2 and C-3PO landing on Tatooine that convinced 20th Century Fox to fund Star Wars, which became the biggest money-making movie at the time. McQuarrie was also the conceptual artist on The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. He played the uncredited role of General Farrell McQuarrie in The Empire Strikes Back, glimpsed in Echo Base on Hoth in the film's opening sequence. An action figure based on the character was released for the Star Wars 30th Anniversary Collection. Action figures based on McQuarrie's concept designs have also been released. Although Ralph McQuarrie will always be remembered for his work on Star Wars, he was also a concept illustrator for other notable projects. In 1978, he worked on the Battlestar Galactica television series. He designed the alien ships in Steven Spielberg's Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and later for E.T. the Extraterrestrial. McQuarrie's work on Ron Howard's 1985 film Cocoon earned him an Academy Award for Best Visual Effects. He later worked with Spielberg again on Raiders of the Lost Ark and Jurassic Park, and also on Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home, and Batteries Not Included. Producer Rick McCallum offered the conceptual artist position to Ralph McQuarrie for the Star Wars prequels, but McQuarrie respectfully declined the offer, saying he had creatively run out of steam. The artist duties were then handed over to Doug Chiang for the prequels. Shortly afterwards, McQuarrie retired, and his Star Wars concept paintings were displayed in art exhibits, most notably as part of the 1999 Star Wars: The Magic of Myth exhibit. Several of McQuarrie's unused designs from the original trilogy were used for the Star Wars: The Clone Wars cartoon series, including the planet Ordo Plutonia, which was his original design for Hoth. Ralph McQuarrie died on Sunday, March 3rd, 2012 in his Berkeley, California home from complications of Parkinson's disease. He is survived by his wife, Joan. George Lucas commented after McQuarrie's death, quote, "His genial contribution in the form of unequaled production paintings propelled and inspired all of the cast and crew of the original Star Wars trilogy. When words couldn't convey my ideas, I could always point to one of Ralph's fabulous illustrations and say, do it like this," end quote. Star Wars concept artist Ralph McQuarrie, June 13th, 1929, March 3rd, 2012.
So that was a couple of weekends ago now, Ralph McQuarrie. And like I said, I was in contact with Doug Chiang here. He lives here in the Bay Area. He's a little busy, like I said.
A little
working
busy.
Working on comic books and movies and other things.
Mm-hmm.
But he was kind enough to answer three important questions that I asked him via email. And he gave me the okay to share it with all of you guys. So here's what Doug Chiang, his thoughts on Ralph McQuarrie. The first thing I asked him was, talk about, just reflect on Ralph McQuarrie's career. And he says, Doug Chiang says, "Ralph is the godfather of film concept design. Of all the film designers, his career is the one that defines what a great concept designer should be, both professionally and personally. He's the gold standard by which most of us are judged." Then I asked him, what, if any, influence? What influence did Ralph McQuarrie have on his work, his career? And Doug says, "Most of us working in film design today can trace our careers to that first Ralph moment, when we first saw his art. For me, I was 15, perusing the local bookstore when I came across a book called Star Wars. On the back cover was Ralph's painting of the X-Wing in the Death Star Trench. Something about that painting captivated me, and I bought the book solely because of it. It was only later that I learned that this book was a novelization of a film that was going to be released later that year. Shortly after Star Wars came out, I knew I wanted to be a concept designer. I learned by studying Ralph's work, and the more I tried to emulate his art, the more I grew to appreciate his artistic skills. He made it look so simple and effortless. Only later would I learn that simplicity is the hallmark of great design. Great design should look simple and effortless, but only if you manage to accomplish it that well." That was the genius of Ralph McQuarrie. Then I also asked him, like you heard in that little tribute there, I also asked him what it felt like to try to fill his shoes later on in the prequels. And he says, "Terrified. When I first started working on the prequels, I knew that I would be judged against Ralph and that it would be a no-win situation. My only hope wasn't Obi-Wan. His only hope was not to ruin his legacy. Thankfully, George told us during our first art review to throw out all our preconceived ideas of what the prequel should be and start fresh. He didn't want us to recreate what had been done before. I felt as if a huge weight had been lifted. I didn't have to try and be Ralph. Nevertheless, Ralph was my mentor, and I emulated him as much as I could. His huge body of work always served as my foundation." And again, that's thoughts from Doug Chiang, concept designer on the prequels, about his mentor, Ralph McQuarrie, who passed away a few weekends ago now. So there you go. We had to do that because we were going to do it the day it happened, the week that it happened, I should say. But I was holding off on Doug Chiang, and well worth it, I think. So you ready?
Well worth it.
You ready to get ready for WonderCon? I get a dollar every time I say ready. So you ready to get ready for WonderCon?
I'm ready.
All right.
Are they ready?
Stretch out. Make yourselves comfortable. I'm telling you, those of you who are not going to be there, guess what you're going to miss. Yeah, but by the time you finish this show, it'll feel like you were at WonderCon. So here we go. Let's start off with, who else? David Glanzer, Director of Marketing Public Relations for Comic-Con International. They put on WonderCon and Ape and a little convention in San Diego that happens every summer. You may have heard of it. San Diego Comic-Con. So stay right there. We'll get started right after this.
Hold on. The Geek Speak Show will be right back.
The folks behind Comic-Con in San Diego now bring you WonderCon in Anaheim. Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. WonderCon guests include Jim Lee, Mike Mignola, J. Michael Straczynski, Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum, Emma Stone, and Alexander Skarsgård, plus TV and movie sneak peeks. WonderCon has comic book publishers, gaming, a masquerade, and more. WonderCon, Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. For info, visit WonderCon.org. That's WonderCon.org.
We're back on the Geek Speak Show. Here's Henry and Romo.
Well, just me right now. Welcome back to the Geek Speak Show. So here we go. Part two of our warm-up to WonderCon show started last week. Had a lot of fun with that one. Having a lot of more fun with this one. And like I said, we're just getting started. Of course, like I said last week, it's not a WonderCon show without our annual visit with David Glanzer, Director of Marketing and Public Relations for Comic-Con International. They put on WonderCon Ape here in San Francisco and a little convention in San Diego. You may have heard of it. David, welcome back to the Geek Speak Show.
Hey, thanks for having me back.
Yeah, our pleasure having you here. So we've been getting excited. We just got the announcement. When was it? I think it was last week that Prometheus was just added with Sir Ridley Scott and Damon Lindelof. So really looking forward to that one.
Can you believe that?
Yeah.
We had heard about that earlier on, and we couldn't really talk about it. And it was just like, oh my gosh, I hope it happens. So we're really excited.
Yeah, and by the way, also Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter's also been added to that.
Yeah, you know, it's got a really kind of cool lineup. We're even having Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum are stopping by on Friday for 21 Jump Street. And I don't know if you've checked it out, but it's tracking pretty good, so that should be a lot of fun, too.
Yeah, so in case you haven't noticed, we're talking about WonderCon 2012, which is happening at the Anaheim Convention Center this year. Not usually in San Francisco, not this time around in Anaheim. And first question I want to ask you, David, is moving it to Anaheim for this year, was it a lot easier to get the big names just because you're there in Hollywood?
No, you know, I have to tell you, WonderCon is kind of, you know, we actually compete against ourselves. You know, we run Comic-Con, WonderCon, and Ape, as you mentioned. But we try to make each one the best it possibly can. And, you know, in the past, WonderCon has had, like, the cast from Star Trek. It's had a lot of guests at WonderCon that actually haven't even done San Diego. So I don't know if it's any more difficult or any easier, but Comic-Con has, I mean, WonderCon has a good cachet, and it was great to be able to get the people we were for that show. We're really excited about it.
Yeah, last year you had Neil Gaiman, the Doctor Who panel here at WonderCon.
Yeah, exactly. So I think there'll be some surprises this year, too, and you know, I'm kind of sorry we're not in the Bay Area. We would like to have been, but, you know, Moscone's doing some renovations, so they kind of booted us out for a year, but we hope to be back.
Yeah, and here on the Geek Speak Show, it seems like we get an invitation to a new convention, like, seems like every other day or every other week. What do you, in your opinion, what do you think it is that makes Comic-Con, of course, but especially WonderCon so popular?
Well, you know, it sounds cheesy, but we really do, and I've said it before, we really do put on the type of show we want to attend. So when it comes down to, you know, whether it's comics guests, whether it's gaming, whether it's film or television, we really try to put together something that we'll enjoy, and also we really think about the fans, too. Will they like this? And we've been very, very lucky in that, you know, we've been kind of on the same wavelength. And I think also the publishers in Hollywood know that, you know, we put on some pretty great shows, so I think they trust us. They know that we can fill the seats in theaters and the program rooms and all that, so, you know, they trust us to deliver a good show, and luckily we backed it up with the fans who come to the door, so it's good all the way around.
Yeah, and I noticed in the program, and you guys can check it out, by the way, on WonderCon.org, or just go to our link section, it's all up on there. But I've noticed also there's a lot more, I don't know if you did it on purpose, a lot more focus on more the creative process, like the comics connection is one, and it's a lot more workshops, actually.
Yeah, there always is. You know, the comics, it's funny, the comics creator connection was something we started at Ape. I think it was the year before last, I'm not sure. And, you know, it was an opportunity to try to get, we always heard about artists wanting to illustrate, you know, writers who wanted to write, but there wasn't really a way to get them together. So we started this, and it's proved pretty successful. We're continuing at WonderCon, and hopefully, you know, we'll see some, I don't know, some benefits from this a couple years down the road where, you know, some people can actually meet up, click, and do some really cool stuff.
Yeah, we had Doug Neff on last week talking about it, and he had a lot of really good things to say about it. Tell us about some of the special guests and some of the programming that we're going to see at WonderCon.
Well, you know what, we have a pretty good lineup. I mean, Jim Lee's going to be at the show, Arthur Adams, Mark Evanier, who's always great and a lot of fun, Rebecca Isaacs. I mean, it's going to be a pretty cool lineup. And programming is always pretty amazing, too. I think, you know, one of the things that people always forget is, especially people who aren't familiar with the show, is the exhibit floor is pretty dynamic. It's a lot of fun. But it's the programming that really counts. When you have a program with J. Michael Straczynski or Mark Waid, I mean, it's just really, really cool. And add to that, like you said, the hands-on workshops, the CAC, the Comics Art Conference, that looks at comics from a more serious point of view. It's a lot of fun. There's a lot of education. But we also have a masquerade. So, you know what? I think it'll be a great weekend for all who come up.
Yeah, I was actually going to ask you. That's one of the big things here at WonderCon in San Francisco is the masquerade. There's still going to be a masquerade over there, right?
Yeah, we're still doing the masquerade. Our bad sales have been up, so that's good. I hope we get some really, really cool people at the masquerade. I'm sure they won't disappoint. You know, doing this in Anaheim is like almost starting from the ground floor. It's a new venue. It's a new city. We had to try to figure out, you know, how we were going to advertise it, how, you know, we're going to appeal to a whole new audience to come. We hope people who've been to WonderCon before check us out. We hope some of the people who have been to Comic-Con check us out. But also, if you've never been to Comic-Con, if you've never been to a convention, now's your opportunity to check one out that's a lot of fun, a lot less stress than San Diego, but just as much, I think, fun and excitement.
How have the sales been? Have you been tracking that?
Pretty good. You know, we were really worried because, again, when you're in a new venue, you just don't know. You just don't know what's going to happen.
Right.
Our exhibit sales started off really strong, and in fact, they moved us from our original hall to a slightly larger hall. And this year, the WonderCon exhibit floor will actually be a little bit bigger than it was last year. I think we have an additional like 200 exhibitors, which is really nice. And the badge sales have been going very well too. They're up from last year, and we thought if we could break even or we probably expect a little dip too because it's a brand new market, but sales seem to be doing pretty well. So I think it's going to end up being a nicely attended show, and those people will really get to take part in some really amazing programs.
Another special guest that I'm looking forward to, and you forgot to mention there, is Will Wheaton, another favorite
Will
here
Wheaton,
on the show.
Yeah, he's going to be there, I think, on Saturday, and he's doing a panel, and he's a lot of fun. I think it'll be great to interact with him. And if you go to our website, you'll see a really, really interesting picture of him wearing his fez.
Yeah, it's actually up on our link section. You guys can take a look at that, what David's talking about.
Awesome.
And also let's also tell them about the Comic Creator Connection. That is, along with Comic-Con and WonderCon, that's one of the only ones that actually requires registration for it, right?
Yeah, and that's just so that we don't have too many of one or too many of the other. You know, a lot of times we get a lot of artists, not enough writers, a lot of writers, not enough artists. But at those types of things, I mean, there's no additional fee, but we do ask you to register so that we can go ahead and pair up. And it's almost kind of like one of those dating services, but it's to see if you match as a creator or an artist. So we pair writers with artists, artists with writers, and you get a few minutes to kind of figure it out, and hopefully some people will click and produce a great work down the road.
Sort of like a geek dating service, if you could call it.
It is, but one for, you know, comics.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and I'm looking at the website right now, actually, and the Saturday registration for writers is closed as of right now. So just letting you guys know that. And if you guys want to register, programs at comiccon.org is where you go, and that's how you register for that.
Yeah, and I think you have a link up on your site, but then we also are using the My Schedule again, I believe. So you can go through the program and pick what it is you want to see and kind of plan out your whole window.
Yeah, that's the one I couldn't figure out last year, I think.
Yeah, you know what, I'm going to share this with you and just between us and your listeners. Not very tech savvy, I couldn't figure it out either, but it's supposed to be easy.
Yeah, a lot of nice little pictures there, so you guys will figure it out.
Exactly.
So we're talking.
And once they figure it out, they can tell us, right?
Yeah. David Glanzer is Director of Marketing and Public Relations for Comic-Con International. They put on WonderCon and Ape and Comic-Con in San Diego. So before we let you go, David, let's talk about the elephant in the room, and that is, are you coming back to San Francisco?
We want to. But I will be honest with you. We can't seem to get dates any farther out than 6 months. So, you know, this had been planned on being a one-time thing. We're hoping that fans who in the Bay Area who love WonderCon will maybe jot a little note to the Convention and Visitors Bureau asking, you know, for us to come back. Don't be mean. Don't be, you know, just a nice friendly little note saying, hey, we really miss WonderCon. We'd love to see it back here, and maybe we can sway them to invite us back even earlier still.
Yeah, so like David said, don't be mean, you know, just send a little note and say, hey, please let them know so we can have WonderCon again in San Francisco.
Exactly, exactly. That you love WonderCon and you hope that it comes back. That would be great.
Yeah, you know, and for once, I actually wasn't watching the news, but is Comic-Con sold out yet, or are there still badges available?
Comic-Con sold out.
Okay.
Although I will tell you, and you know, we always make refunds and cancellations available. So I'd say probably sometime after the middle of May or so, you'll probably see another round of badges going up for sale.
Yeah. So keep on checking the website. And APE is still happening, of course. That's in October 13th, 14th here in San Francisco.
Yeah, and that's, you know, that's one of my favorite shows. I mean, you know, it's got about 5,500 people. You know, it's a self-published underground comics and all that. You get to meet the creators right across the table. It's just a fun, laid-back show, and it's just one of my favorites.
And very creative, I got to say. I mean, we've been there, you know, a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Ape, and
you had your just family there, creative. I think, last year, no?
Hanging out with all of you guys. But everybody there, you can see, you can feel the passion for their comics, their projects, whatever it is. That's why I love Ape.
Me too. You know, it's funny. I had spoken to a creator last year who do a book that was really, really cool that I really loved. And it was nice to be able to sit and chat for a few minutes without, you know, having to worry about, you know, just thousands of people behind you waiting for the same opportunity. It's a nice group. Everybody's low-key and relaxed. And it's great to meet these creators firsthand and spend some, you know, quality time with them. It really is fun.
Yeah, so again, WonderCon happening this weekend in Anaheim. You just go to wondercon.org. There should be some passes still available. There's going to be available at the door, right, David?
There will be passes available, yeah. What is it, the 15th, 16th? Oh, my gosh. I should have the dates.
The
emblazoned.
Yeah, 16th, 17th, and 18th.
16th through the 18th, yeah.
And, it's okay, I have to look at the calendar, too.
You should be able to walk up to the door and get tickets, although if you go online, I think they're a little bit less expensive.
Yeah, so again, thanks a lot, David, and you know, you're always welcome here. We'll see you at WonderCon.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Going on with the warm-up, the WonderCon show, just talked to David Glanzer. Thanks a lot for that. He's one of the many people who put on WonderCon, Ape, and a little convention in San Diego. You guys may have heard it or been there yourselves. So let's continue now with last year, actually, let's go back a little bit. Last year at WonderCon here in San Francisco, Marvel Comics was a huge and very welcome presence there. You could tell by the lines and just everybody had a lot of fun in all the panels. And this year, they're going to be there again. Two panels that I really want to talk about because I'm going to be there. You guys know, you hear me all the time, make mine Marvel. So, of course, I'm going to be at these two. Let's have somebody on who's been on the show before. Welcome him back to the show. Jeph Loeb, head of Marvel Television. Welcome back to the Geek Speak Show.
Thank you very much. It's always good to be here.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to have you back, Jeph. So the first thing let's talk about before WonderCon was just announced the Marvel Universe block premiering April 1st on Disney XD. So tell us about that, please.
Well, we're very excited. You know, this is something that when I came on board about 2 years ago as the head of television, this was really our goal, which was to create a place where Marvel fans, new fans, families, you know, anybody who wanted to see brand new content coming out of Marvel could have a destination to go to, and that's the Marvel Universe block. We premiere on April the 1st on Disney XD. We're on at 11 o'clock in the morning. It will open with a brand new series that obviously we've been talking a lot about for the last year, and that's Ultimate Spider-Man. And for everybody that's been a fan of Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes, there are brand new episodes starting on April the 1st as well. In addition, there'll be some surprises, some shorts, some interstitials, some things that we haven't revealed to everybody yet. And there might be a sneak peek of that when we get to WonderCon. But the thing that I really wanted to stress to everybody and that has me very excited is that when you stop and you take a look at how big and expanding the Marvel Universe is becoming, you know, whether it is that we're in publishing or we're in digital, where, you know, over the last weekend we just had a huge announcement with regards to Infinite Comics and with Marvel AR. And then, of course, we've got this little tiny art house film on May 4th called The Avengers that has a couple of people that I think people know, like Iron Man, the Hulk, Captain America, Thor, Nick Fury, Hawkeye, Black Widow, all in one big, gigantic movie from the genius mind of Joss Whedon. You know, when you take a look at that, and then you also know that, you know, in July, they're rebooting the Spider-Man franchise, so that the two real big, giant franchises that Marvel has, which is Spider-Man and the Avengers, in your movie theaters that'll be dominating all summer long, well, that's where we are at Marvel Universe. That's where we are on Disney XD. Our two big shows are Ultimate Spider-Man and Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes.
Yeah, and Ultimate Spider-Man has some great talent, not only behind the voice talent, but also behind the scenes also. Let's talk about the actor, the voice actors first. One I really want to hit on especially is he's back, J.K. Simmons as J. Jonah Jameson, the voice at least.
There was really no other choice. Once we knew that J. Jonah Jameson was going to be in the show, and, you know, as it worked turned out, I don't know whether or not Jameson is in. I don't think he is in the Spider-Man reboot, Amazing Spider-Man, in the movie. But we reached out immediately to J.K. and said, you know, do you want to continue the legacy of playing this character? And he's right there. I mean, he's so much fun to work with. Now, we have a tremendous voice cast. You know, we start with Drake Bell, who many of the listeners will know from the Nickelodeon hit show Drake and Josh. You know, he's an extraordinarily gifted performer. He plays both Peter Parker and Spider-Man, and I really do want to show up that particular point, which is that, you know, they are really different characters, and, you know, and being able to capture both the drama that is Peter's life and the lightheartedness that is Spider-Man and the action and all that comes to being Spider-Man. You know, Drake just stepped right in, and I can't really think of anybody else for the part anymore. Shia McBride, who, you know, folks know from shows like Pushing Daisies, you know, is our Nick Fury. And that is one of the big differences on our show, is that, you know, for the first time, the concept of S.H.I.E.L.D. being involved and Nick Fury having a real role in what's going to happen in Spider-Man's life and making him the ultimate Spider-Man. Stephen Weber, who folks know from Wings and lots of other television, plays Norman Osborn. He's just, you know, incredibly awesome with it. So it's really a terrific cast. And again, keeping in mind this idea of the Marvel Universe and how, you know, one thing leads to another, you know, one of our greatest gifts that we got from the film side was that, you know, Clark Gregg plays Agent Phil Coulson in the movies. You know, we've seen him in Iron Man, we've seen him in Thor. You know, without giving anything away, if you've seen the trailer, you already know that he's in the Avengers. You know, we wanted to have an opportunity to be able to maintain that character. And so Clark Gregg plays Agent Phil Coulson in our show, Ultimate Spider-Man. So it really is, you know, making it all feel like one Marvel experience.
Yeah, and also recurring guest role from one Stan Lee playing Stan the Janitor.
And, you know, you can't do these without having your Stan cameo. So he's so fantastic.
Yeah, like we're talking to Jeph Loeb, head of Marvel Television. He's going to be at WonderCon. A couple of panels, both on Saturday, March 17th. The first one, 12 p.m., the Marvel Television Presents panel in room 213. The second one takes place at 2 p.m., also in room 213. This one is for arguably the biggest event in comics this summer, and that's Avengers versus X-Men. Now, don't give us any spoilers. I know you may give it, tease a little bit at the panel, but tell us what you can or what you want about Avengers versus X-Men.
Well, I think it is, you know, I was with Axel Alonso down at South by Southwest in Austin this weekend, and he really coined the phrase, which is, he can't think of three words that will get comic book fans more excited than Avengers versus X-Men.
Yeah.
You know, these are our two biggest teams. What I love about the story, and I've, you know, been at all the creative retreats and talk with the guys. I mean, you've got five top writers, you've got three incredibly talented artists, and they're pulling it all together in a story that, you know, spreads out. It's 12 issues over a 6-month period, so that, you know, it's shipping twice a month. It's just epic in its feeling. And, you know, and I got very lucky in the sense that Avengers Extinction is the warm-up. It's the prelude, you know. There are things, and that fourth issue ships very shortly, and you'll see some very interesting turns that happen at the very end there that will help kick off what's going on. And it leads, Avengers Extinction number 4 leads directly into AVX, Avengers vs. X-Men number 0. So you'll see a whole sweeping movement going right in that direction. It's just a jet engine that's going to go on throughout the summer.
Yeah, and it's one of the most pre-ordered books so far. Like I said, it is arguably the biggest event in comic books happening this summer. One thing I don't want to forget about this, let's go back to the Ultimate Spider-Man series. Not only the talent, the voice talent, but the talent behind the scenes also, including yourself. Talk about your team.
It's really extraordinary. You know, again, one of the things that I wanted to do when I came over from the creative side over to actually running television was that, you know, I'm a real big believer from, you know, my own experiences on Smallville and on Lost and on Heroes, that the writer's room is what's going to make a show. And that, you know, normally what happens when you do these shows is that the executive producer sits down with the story editor, they break out what the story ideas are, they go find a freelance writer, they hand out the work, it comes back, and then the story editor's responsibility is to recreate it. And to make sure that it fits in with the big picture. We wanted to have something that felt of a piece. We wanted to put together a room that, you know, I sort of refer to as the murderer's row of animation writers. And that people, and this is really important for us, is that, you know, this show is the first time that everybody that's involved on a Spider-Man series comes from Marvel. Everyone that's working there, you know, the entire top to bottom from the creative side of things, are those people. So you start right at the top. Joe Quesada, our chief creative officer, and obviously somebody who's drawn and written some great Spidey stories. We added to that Man of Action, who are our supervising producers on the show, and look after the day-to-day as to what's going on. You know, Man of Action may not be a name that you know, but you actually know them very well. You know, they created two little shows, one called Ben 10, another one called Generator Rex. And these are the guys. This is Joe Kelly, Joe Casey, Duncan Rouleau, Steve Siegel. They're names that everybody knows from comics, but they also know them in the animation world. So they have an extraordinary love for not just Spider-Man, but for the Marvel Universe as well. And then we didn't stop there. We wanted, coming out of the gate, we wanted somebody who would immediately say to people that, you know, Marvel Animation is a different kind of house. It is a brand new place where we're going to be telling the best stories that we can in the mighty Marvel tradition. And that began with going and reaching out to a two-time Emmy winner, Paul Dini. And, you know, Paul is known for such shows as Batman Animated and Batman Beyond, but he's literally done hundreds of hours of animation, some of the best favorite things that you guys know. He's also worked on Lost. And, you know, what a lot of people didn't know was, because he's known for doing such great work with our distinguished competition, that they didn't know is that he's actually a big Marvel zombie. And there's times that he can geek in the room better than anybody else out there. And so, Paul wrote our pilots. That's the first two episodes. And really gave us sort of the guidance for what the show is going to be, in addition to the fact that he stayed on as a creative consultant and producer on the show. And so he's there every single week making sure that we're living up to the best show that we can make. Now, you would think that with just that, that would be enough. But in the Mighty Marvel tradition, you know, we always got to go one step further, in that we reached out to the guy who's written every single issue of Ultimate Spider-Man. It's over 150 issues. And that's Brian Michael Bendis. And, you know, Brian came on board. He's a creative consultant for the series. In addition to that, he's also written some of our favorite episodes. So, you know, it really is a great gang to be with. And when you're in that writer's room and the ideas are flying around, we just have so much fun putting Spider-Man not only into some of the greatest action that we'll see, but also into some great humorous moments that I think people are really going to enjoy.
Yeah, and again, this premieres Sunday, April 1st on Disney XD at 11 a.m. Eastern and Pacific. Ultimate Spider-Man, Avengers, Earth's Mightiest Heroes. The second season kicks off also in the short form, what would you call them, a series, I guess, or interstitials, you call them?
Yes, we call them, they're promos, they're shorts, they're interstitials. They're just fun things that we've been messing around with that will fill out the Marvel Universe block that is besides the our two big blockbuster shows, that being Ultimate Spider-Man and Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes Season 2.
Yeah, you know, I just thought of something right now. Brian Bendis is on. He's been on the show before, and we talked about, you know, when he introduced Miles Morales. Since he's become such a popular character, are there any plans to include him in this series or have his own series?
I think you have to stay tuned. Anything can happen in Spidey's world, and that's the part that's so exciting for us.
See, all the more reason to stay tuned. So again, Jeph Loeb, he will be there at WonderCon this week, and those of you who are going to be in Anaheim, two panels, both on Saturday, March 17th. The first one, 12 p.m., the Marvel Television Presents panel, room 213. The second, AVX, Avengers versus X-Men. You guys all know about this one already, but you're going to find out more at 2 p.m., also in room 213. So Jeph, thanks a lot for coming on and teasing us and getting us just a little bit more excited than we already were about all these Marvel projects coming up.
Henry, it's great, and, you know, I love the show, and anytime you want to have us back, let us know.
Anytime. You're welcome back anytime, and we'll see you this weekend.
Take care.
All right, so thanks, Jeph Loeb, for talking about that. The Marvel panels will be on Saturday, March 17th in room 213, 12 p.m., 2 p.m. Find out all about Spectacular Spider-Man and all the Marvel TV stuff coming in, also Avengers versus X-Men. Like I said, the biggest event, arguably, in comics this summer. So let's stick with comic books, somebody who's been on the show before. And look who else is on the show. So you're done with the packing?
I'm like halfway there.
Okay, so she actually stepped out for a little bit. She was packing, so Violet's back now.
It's going to take me a while.
So let me introduce you, actually. Yeah, you weren't here the last couple times that Scott Marcano, Mr. Diablo, has been on the show with us.
No, I was not.
So Scott, welcome back to the Geek Speak show again.
Hey, guys. It's good to see you, Henry. Or we'll talk to you. No, I'm not actually seeing you.
But, yeah. Yeah. We'll actually see you again this weekend at WonderCon.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. It'll be great.
Yeah. He'll be there this weekend for those of you who are going to WonderCon in the small press area. Table 98. You'll be there all weekend, I'm assuming?
Yeah, I'll be there. I'm actually going down tomorrow to set up the booth, and I'll be there for the duration. Till they release me from, they undo the manacle on my leg and let me walk out of the convention center.
Yeah, so the last time we saw you was at Ape here in San Francisco back in October. It seems like it was just yesterday. Times have just been flying by. So what's been happening with you since we last saw you at Ape?
Well, a lot of good things. I've been actually, you know, I have my my three main graphic novels, Nancy Nendez and the Black Widows and The Unwanted. And since Ape, we've been working really hard because we've had a lot of interest in doing those graphic novels as films. So we've been actually setting up Hum and Nancy Nendez and the Black Widows as film projects, and it's looking really good. We have a couple companies interested, a lot of great actors who have attached to the projects. So it looks like we're going forward with those two as films. So that's kind of been the main thing I've been up to. And then we're developing a new graphic novel, a vampire story, which is really cool. So that's kind of what Diablo Productions has been up to since Ape.
Yeah, you actually, I think you mentioned it in the interview at Ape, and you guys can listen to it on our YouTube channel. It's on there. The vampire one, and you know, we were joking about it, but it's true. They don't twinkle in yours, do they, or sparkle?
No sparkling, no shiny skin. They're not looking for dates.
I remember our story. It's kind of like,
oh gosh, you know. I support the Twilight thing. I do, but it's not my major thing. I remember there was a shirt going around Comic-Con a couple of years ago where it had that dude from Twilight's head severed, and Bela Lugosi is holding it, and it says something like, "Real vampires look like this." Yeah. I'm kind of that crowd a little bit. So, so, but yeah, our vampire story is like an Old West vampire story. It's kind of a little bit like that old classic movie, The Magnificent Seven. There's a little pueblo down in New Mexico that's kind of being overrun by bandits, and the town has nowhere to turn. So what they end up doing is they end up hiring vampires and paying them with their blood to protect the town. And the illustrator is going to be Juan Romero, who did Nancy Hernandez and the Black Widows with us. It's going to be in full color, and it should come out. We'll have a lot of it done by Ape next year, so we'll see if we probably won't have the full book done by then, but it's definitely going to be going, you know, probably by this time next year, the whole book will be done for sure, and we'll be premiering it maybe WonderCon next year. So we're working hard on it. It's all written, and we're starting getting into the illustrations, and we're really excited about it.
So since you've been working on these movies, I was wondering, when you are writing now, do you think of, like, the movie while you're writing for your new projects, or you just write as
sometimes, you know, it depends on the project. Some of them, you know, some of the things I've been working on have no movie aspect at all. There was a project I did for an educational foundation last year, which was an anti-gang graphic novel, and it was... That really didn't have any movie thing, and I didn't think about it. It was purely to create an anti-gang book. And so in that case, yeah, it never entered my mind. With the new one we're talking about, Rio Sangre, that's the name of the new one we're coming out. Yeah, it definitely has like a movie bent to it, because it was kind of inspired by one of my favorite movies, which was The Seven Samurai and The Magnificent Seven, which is actually a takeoff of The Seven Samurai. So yeah, kind of was in my head, I was thinking, you know, at some point this might make a cool, you know, film as I was working on the graphic novel script. So, yeah, definitely on some of them now, especially since some of our projects are going in that direction. I think about it a lot more than I used to. Like, you know, will that work as a movie? I try not to let it... I try to think about the graphic novel working first, because if it doesn't work there, it's never going to be anything. But, yeah, it's something I think about now more than I used to.
Yeah, because is that the first time you actually work on movies, right? Because you did one movie starring Pauly Shore a few years ago, right? Tell everybody what that one is.
Yeah, I broke it. That's how it was one of the first things I ever did. I was in college at the time, and this guy came up to me, and he said, there's a producer at 20th Century Fox. He needs a writer, and they'll pay you $600. And to me, that was like a fortune. I was like, oh, I'm going to get so much money for this. This is great. And I was a film student at the time at USC, and, you know, not knowing that was like nothing, and I was being completely ripped off. But, you know, I said, what the heck? And I wrote it anyway, and it turned into the comedy Biodome with Pauly Shore. And I ended up making a lot more money after it went on, fortunately. I made more than $600. But that kind of broke me into the industry. And that's how I originally started. I was a screenwriter. And then I went back into comic books because I was successful writing a lot of films. And I was writing films for Disney and stuff. And so I had the time, and I also had the money to really get into graphic novels and comic books. So then I kind of, you know, starting about 7 years ago, I started developing comic books and graphic novels and started Diablo Productions. And then, you know, now things have come full circle, because now the graphic novels, which were really just kind of an outlet for me away from the film business, now they're like, oh, that'd make a great movie. Why don't you turn that into a movie? So so it's kind of come all the way back around. These things I was doing just for creative expression have now become film properties. So I'm like, oh, okay, well, that works.
Yeah, we're talking to Scott Marcano. You guys know him as Mr. Diablo, writer, producer, Diablo Productions. He'll be at WonderCon this weekend in Anaheim, the small press area, table 98. You'll be there all weekend. Stop by, say hi. You'll be doing signings, I'm assuming?
Yeah, I'll be signing everything, and we have some good stuff. We started a new print series, which I think people will really enjoy. It's Superheroes Gone Bad, and we kind of Diabloized everybody. We have like prints of great illustrations. It'll be like Batman as a demon, the Joker as an angel. We have Superman as a tyrant with cracking a whip all over the human beings who work for him. It's kind of demented, but people really love these prints. They're really cool. So that's another thing we're doing. If you stop by, yeah, ask for the Superheroes Gone Bad series, and we'll hook you up.
Yeah, again, that's Table 98 all weekend. Just stop by there and ask for that. You mentioned The Hums is one of the projects that's going to be turned into a film. I remember when you first showed it to us at Ape, a couple of years ago, and I think it was, the thing that stood out to all of us is the use of the color and then the black and white plot device in the story. Will that be used in the film in any way?
No, they're not going to go that way. They just, you know, because people expect to see. I thought it would be cool, but, you know, that when we talked about it with the producers and stuff, you know, people expect a movie in color.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's kind of hard to really get them to do black and white. So they said, nah, let's just do it all in color. You know, the dream. Because the main reason we did the black and white and color effect in the graphic novel was it really made. There's this. If you're not familiar with the story, one of the characters has a drug addiction, and when he's high or he's having a flashback, everything would suddenly go into color in the graphic novel, and they made that very vivid. And for the film version, you know, the producers and the director, you know, kind of putting out that, you know what, we can make that effect happen without having to do a color transition. You know, there's so many things they can do with visual effects to make the sort of dream drug sequence look really vivid and very distinct. So So, yeah, they're going to go all color with it. So, yeah, but it's a good question. I lobbied for it, but they were like, meh, you know.
Yeah, it would have looked real cool on screen, I think.
I was with you on that one, but you know what? Sometimes you're, you know, when you get into film, too, you immediately discover, you go from being like, hey, I get to make all the decisions, to like, oh, well, I have to convince a room full of people.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's harder. But, yeah, I lobbied for it, but, yeah, it didn't make the cut. So I'm sure what they're going to end up doing will look really cool, so I'm excited, to see what they come up with anyway. But, yeah, it would have been interesting to see it as black and white in color. I would agree. That would have been really interesting.
Yeah, that's something else that I've always wondered, actually, and you're the perfect person to ask, is when one of your properties is turned into a film, does it become that a lot where you know, it's your creation, but then when you get into the boardroom, you just, okay, just sit over there on the side and be quiet, and we know what to do with it.
They try that, and you know, fortunately, I'm really like a pest. I never shut up. That's what it's my thing that I care about. So, you know, yeah, hopefully it's cool, you know. I mean, I haven't really had a lot of situations where I'm just, you know, really scandalized and mad and, you know, how dare you, you know, do that to my beautiful, you know, script or whatever. I mean, certainly on Biodome, I wasn't tripping. You know, I was like, okay, what are you going to do with it? You know, they're going to do what they want, but it was fine. But, you know, they didn't alter it that much, you know, and the way things are shaping up on Hum and you know, on Nancy Hernandez, they're not getting altered that much, so it's good. Luckily, I think it just comes down to when you pick the right people who really see what you see to begin with, and that helps a lot because you're almost all the way there. You know, they're not going to really turn it into something else. They're close to what your vision is, which helps. But, yeah, there's a part of you that always has to let go, because when you make a graphic novel and it's your company making it, you have 100% creative control. You don't want something, you know, you want to do it in black and white or color. It's all yours. And when you get into the film thing, you just have to emotionally go, I'm going to lose control. There has to be a part of me that lets go of this, and I have to let it becomes a collective process. You know, there's the producers involved, there's the director, everybody's got a different opinion. Yeah, and it takes, you have to be kind of thick-skinned to say, okay, I'm not going to hang on to everything. I know some things are going to change, you know. Like we were talking about the color and the black and white. I like that, the fact that they want to do it as more a visual effect. You know, I can live with it. I'm not going to go smash everything off the desk and start screaming.
You know, it also, and you'll understand this reference, it's kind of like being a parent. You got to let your kids grow up.
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly what it feels like. At a certain point, you have to let your kids, you have to let them grow off and grow up and fly on their own. And you have to be open to it. Sometimes what works in a graphic novel may not work in a film, and you have to be willing to, like, maybe it works even better the way they want to do it. And you have to kind of let them do it. I mean, the good thing is, on everything I'm involved in now, I'm in the room. It's not like, go home and we'll call you and we'll give you a free ticket and some popcorn. At least I'm there to talk about it, so I kind of know what's going on and I'm part of the decision-making process. You know, I don't get the final say, but I definitely have my input. So far, so good. You know, nothing's happened that's, like I said, this made me just, you know, flip out and storm away and throw, you know, start shooting, you know, paintballs at the Hollywood sign. How dare you, bastard?
Yeah, and speaking of, at Abe, you gave me a copy of Nancy Hernandez and the Black Widows. You guys loved it. My wife, she read it. We loved it. So good job on that.
Oh, thank you very much, Henry. I appreciate it. Yeah, it's one of my favorite. I'm really excited to do that one. We got some great people involved. Eugenio Debrez, if you're not familiar with his work, he's like the Adam Sandler of Mexico and Latin America. He's hilarious. He's going to play a part in it. Danny Trejo has signed up to be in it. Tony Todd is going to sign up to do it. So we got some great people coming together on it. So I'm really excited to see the film version of that one. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
What's Tony Todd going to do? Because he's known as Death in the Final Destination movies, and he's got that voice. He was also the Fallen in the Transformers movie.
We're trying to. Tony has signed up. He said he actually signed up for two different parts. He said he wanted to play. He'd play either one. So we're trying to decide with the producers which one he wants to do. There's a part of a police officer who's investigating Nancy Hernandez's death, Detective Milk.
Yeah.
And Tony's kind of leaning that he wants to play that part and just kind of come on and be this really straight, kind of play the straight man to what's going on, where he's really trying to look for the ghost. So which would be very funny if you ever, you know, Tony's persona is so serious and menacing. I think it'd be really fun. So that's kind of what we're talking to him about, and he wants to do it. So hopefully it'll all play out that way. But yeah, we'll see. You know, they're attaching the cast right now, so we're kind of going through that whole thing. But so far, Tony's been great. He's a really nice guy, and so far everything has worked out great as far as talking to him and working on the project with him. So
I can kind of see actually Danny Trejo playing the either the detective or the bus driver.
They want him to do the bus driver. Because yeah, the bus driver's name is Wolfface.
Yeah.
So like, I think when Danny heard that, he was like, "Oh, that's me." Yeah, exactly. So we're working it out with him. But yeah, I think he'd be great in that part, and he's a super nice guy. So we're hoping that all goes down as we plan, and we're all on the set in a couple months doing it.
So I was wondering, do you have any other projects you're working on right now?
Or? Yeah, as if you don't have enough.
I know, right? He's not busy.
I'm doing a bunch of film projects. I've been hired to do a couple things, a couple different scripts, and I'm working on those now. I have another film, which is a political drama that's going into production in about a month or two, which is about a Peruvian hostage crisis that took place in Lima in 1996.
Mm-hmm.
And then comic book-wise, yeah, we're focusing on that one graphic novel. I just wrapped up doing this this anti-gang graphic novel, which is it's mainly going to be distributed to anti-gang centers and also to within the school system in California.
Mm-hmm.
It's going out through a place called the Vinapia Foundation, which is a nonprofit. So I just wrapped that up. If I get a breath of air, I'll probably start another comic book really soon. I have one that's kind of more of a straightforward sort of, it's like a roommate kind of story, less monsters mm-hmm. and stuff. I wanted to try one in that realm. So it's more of a character story that I'm writing out right now. So I may get into that next once we get the vampire one a little farther along. So maybe it'll be a little departure for Diablo Productions. Nobody dies in it. Nobody gets eaten by a monster. But maybe that's good for us to take a break from that for like at least one book. Let's go back to it, what we normally do.
Yeah, so you guys know him as Mr. Diablo, Scott Marcano, writer-producer, Diablo Productions. They'll be at WonderCon this weekend for those of you who are going there. Table 98 in the small press section. You'll be there all weekend. Just get some of these things. You'll love them. Trust me, I know. I've read some of them, and you guys will love them too. He'll happily sign some of them for you. So, Scott, thanks a lot. We'll see you at WonderCon, and you're always welcome back here on the show.
Oh, anytime you guys will have me, I'll be here. I love talking to you, Henry, and it's always great being on your show, and I'm so happy that so many good things are happening with your show, too, and I look forward to seeing you down at the WonderCon this weekend.
Yeah, same with you. Glad big things are happening for both of us, actually.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I'll see you at the Oscars, Henry.
Yeah, we'll share a card down there. I'm not that big yet.
That sounds good.
All right, Scott, we'll see you this weekend.
Okay, take care, Henry.
All right, so that's Scott Marcano, Mr. Diablo, writer-producer, Diablo Productions. He'll be there all weekend. Like I said, Table 98 in the small press section. All right, and here he is, Rod Roddenberry. Been on many times before. CEO of Roddenberry Entertainment, Roddenberry.com. Go to our link section. It's all up on there. Rod, welcome back to the Geek Speak Show.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure to have you here. Before we get into WonderCon and everything else, got to say big, big kudos on Trek Nation. Finally premiered. You were on the night before it premiered. Really loved it, and you've been on before, talked about it a lot, and then got us excited. When we finally saw it, it was even better than what you teased.
Oh, that's so good to hear. Yeah, no, I'm very happy. Thanks to New Animal Productions and the Science Channel, it really came out and it turned out great. The only unfortunate part is that the Science Channel is an amazing channel and something I watch all the time, but it is a slice of the pie out there. Not everyone has it. So my objective is to really get Trek Nation out to as many people as possible. So what I want to do is spend the next, well, really, as long as it takes, year, 2 years, going from convention to convention and showing it to as many people who are willing to see it.
Yeah, and you mentioned last time also that you wanted to release it on Blu-ray. Is that still in the plans?
Absolutely, absolutely. A digital download, DVD, Blu-ray, whatever the case is, that is the intention. The goal with the disc or the physical media that it will come out on is that we have tons of extras, which I mentioned plenty about last time, and that's what we look forward to putting out. Hopefully by the end of the year. I'm so sick of saying dates and being wrong that I'm not going to say anything.
Yeah, is there enough material to do a follow-up, or would you even want to do another follow-up to Trek Nation?
There is literally enough material, and I'm not kidding you at all, to do three or four more documentaries. The hardest part about this, and forgive me if I'm saying something I've said in the past, was condensing my father's 70 years, Star Trek's 45 years, and his impact on the world all into an hour and a half. There was so much left out, so many amazing interviews with people. that we just didn't put in because we didn't have time. It ended up being one of the massive roadblocks for us, is really to figure out what stays and what goes. And our earlier attempts, we were just putting too much in. And again, thanks to science and a new animal, they really helped refine it and give it a good solid direction.
Yeah, like Rod's mentioned, he's going to be at conventions, one of them, this very weekend in Anaheim, WonderCon 2012. You'll have a panel, Roddenberry Presents panel, Sunday, March 18th, 2:30, in room 208. Tell us a little bit what we'll see in that panel.
Well, we're definitely going to be talking about, everything Roddenberry that's coming up, and of course talking about Trek Nation, but we've got a number of other projects that we've been working on that we're really kind of excited about. One of them is called The White Room, or White Room O2B3, and it is we're really proud of this one because we're kind of breaking barriers. We're doing things differently, which I'm a big fan of. We've taken this technology that hasn't been used for any sort of dramatic filmmaking. It's a 360-degree camera. So it literally is a couple of cameras sort of pointed up and shooting at mirrors. And you stick it in the center of a room, and it shoots exactly as you think, 360 degrees. Well, we've created a dramatic piece around that, about a 15 or so minute short, produced by Trevor Roth, directed by Greg Aronowitz, and written by Tori Mell. And it is a unique sci-fi story, very Roddenberry-esque. There's a nice little twist, I think, in it that will make people happy, and it allows us to sort of look at ourselves and our faults and our follies. But I think people really like it.
Is the image, the 360-degree image, do we watch that all at once, or how does that work exactly?
So the trick here is that we get a number of ways that we get to present it. Obviously, we can take the film, the video, from all of these cameras and show it to you traditionally in a two-dimensional screen where it moves from character to character, who's ever talking. However, the intention, what's never been done before, is the idea is this will be projected into a dome-like theater. In fact, anywhere there is a dome theater. So if any of you have ever been to the what do they call it? Sorry.
I know what you're talking
planetariums.
About.
Planetariums. Yeah, that's it. A tough word. Planetariums. If you've ever seen any shows there, that's where we would be projecting it. And there's many hundreds of these screens around the country. And what you do is you'll go into the room, and when you kind of look up, you will see the story unfold in three dimensions. Well, excuse me, not three dimensions, in 360 degrees around you. And you're a little bit more interactive. You kind of can hear the person behind you talking, and you look, and then you look across and you see the other character talking. So it's a really unique and immersive way of doing drama, something that no one's ever done before. And it's an experiment. It really is an experiment. We're all very confident people will enjoy it, but we definitely have questions. It's like, how is the public going to react to not just the story, but this experience?
Yeah, planetarium was what we were thinking about. That's actually what I was thinking about. I was just thinking Biodome, because we just finished talking to the guy who actually wrote the script for Biodome, and I was like, no, not Biodome. It's something with a dome. But yeah, that's what it is. And I've always wondered, actually, when we go see, you know, because when we go to planetariums, I think there's one here in San Francisco, or two here in San Francisco. It's the usual, you know, look at the stars or, you know, whatever it is. I've always wondered, what would a movie look like on this screen? So that's right. What this is going to be.
We're still figuring it out, you know. Sitting down traditionally, unless you have a swivel chair, makes it a little harder. Yeah. So we're really kind of, we're playing with this. And again, this just really speaks to what, I always feel weird talking about Roddenberry because it's my own name, but this is really speaks to what Roddenberry is all about, you know. We're breaking barriers. We're trying new things. We're happy if we fail because we've learned something and we're going to do it better the next time. But it's just important to us to always do it differently. I mean, do it good, but do it in a way that someone really hasn't thought of, something that we think will be successful.
Yeah, you guys all recognize the voice. I've been on many times. Rod Roddenberry, CEO, Roddenberry Entertainment. They'll have a panel Sunday, March 18th at 2:30 in room 208 at Warner Condos, if you are going to be there. And Rod, the last couple times we had you on, you mentioned the Quester tips, and I'm really interested in that because I'd heard about these before. Any progress on those?
Unfortunately, I don't think the Quester tapes. What I talked about before is we were working with an entertainment company here in LA, Imagine Entertainment, I think I can say, and there was we had a potential deal with them to re-envision and reproduce the Quester tapes, which was done by my father in the early '70s. redo that for a modern day release, a modern day TV series. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it just kind of sat for a while, and I don't know why, but it didn't take off. So we're going to probably take it and start, you know, shopping it around at some point again. I'm not in a hurry. The story stands the test of time. If anyone goes onto YouTube and looks up the Questor tapes, they'll see it's got, you know, it's cheesy 70s sci-fi in a way, but the story is really solid. Anyone who loves the character Data will love Questor, because that's where the character Data came from. So I'm in no hurry, but I think it is one of my father's better works, and I do want it to be re-envisioned, so to speak, and come out for modern-day audiences.
And I was wondering, do you have any other events coming up for the Roddenberry Dive Team?
Well, we do. We've got a number of dives coming up. In fact, this weekend, no one can come to this because it's full, but we're doing a behind-the-scenes tour of the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach. We do have a few of more of those scheduled as the year goes on, so please check out our website for that. We've got a dive just before the Long Beach Scuba Show in May. And then we actually have, what's more relevant to this conversation, is we have a Comic-Con dive. This will be our fourth year. And the Thursday morning, I don't know if that's sneak preview night or the first day of Comic-Con, we have a dive in La Jolla Shores. And the objective of this is, you know, I think this appeals to the sci-fi fans out there, because sci-fi fans in general, I think, have more of an open mind and are more interested in exploring alien worlds. So those of you who are divers and live in another state or out of San Diego, please come down and join us for a dive at La Jolla Shores. Check out our awards. Those of you who aren't divers but curious about the sport, curious about the ocean, also please come down. If you come to RoddenberryDiveTeam.com, you'll get all the details there.
Yeah, we got a link up on our link section to the Roddenberry Dive Team and also to Roddenberry Entertainment. There you can check out all everything that's coming from them. And if you really want to see it, you can see and hear from Rod and Trevor and everybody else that's on the team on Sunday, March 18th, 2:30 p.m., room 208 at the Anaheim Convention Center this weekend for WonderCon. Besides WonderCon, Rod, where else can we see Roddenberry Entertainment?
I believe the big one is going to obviously be Comic-Con.
Yeah.
The one that we love a lot is the Star Trek convention in Las Vegas. And I don't have the dates in front of me. I believe that's August, but it's at the Rio Hotel, and it is a blast. I mean, it is so much fun. And I think last year it had about 15,000 fans. So it's definitely one of the larger ones on the West Coast. So we hope that those of you out there who like sci-fi, who like Star Trek, who get and grok Roddenberry, as Will Wheaton would say, we hope you can join us at that event as well.
Yeah, so definitely looking forward to that. Looking forward to WonderCon this weekend. Again, March 18th, Sunday, 2:30 p.m., room 208. The Roddenberry Presents panel. Rod will be there. Trevor, who else is going to be on the panel with you?
Of course, we've got Trevor Roth, who is not only a good friend of mine, but he is really one of the creative forces behind Roddenberry Entertainment right now. Tori Mell, who, as I mentioned, he wrote A White Room, and is he's been involved in just about every creative endeavor, including Days Missing, for those of you who don't know, is a comic book series that we've just announced our third series on that one. So that should be coming out in the relatively near future. And Greg Aronowitz, who was the director of White Room 02B3, he is a creative genius as far as I'm concerned. If you look up Greg Aronowitz online, you'll see a list of credits that it'll make you scratch your head and wonder why he's doing these things, because he's worked with Spielberg, he's worked with Henson, he's worked with a lot of these people. And he, you know, not to put words in his mouth, he really loves the art. He loves the creative side. He loves telling stories. He's not in it for the money. He needs to get paid, but he really enjoys the creative process, and he really enjoys sharing these ideas with like-minded people.
Yeah, so again, that'll be on Sunday, March 18th. We'll all be there. I'm really looking forward to learning more about it and seeing it in White Room 02B3. May not have the same effect because it's not in the, like I said, the planetarium thing, but still want to see what it's going to look like.
Yeah, and it's still a great story. It's still a great story. I know we have a trailer to show you of that. And, oh, actually, I was told that there are going to be some little bit of extra bonus footage from Trek Nation to show anyone who comes to our panel.
So even more reason to go.
Yes, yes. So definitely please come there. And there's so many other projects. I'd love to get into them, but I don't know how much time we have.
Yeah, well, don't want to give it away. Just be there. And if not, then you'll hear about it later on and wish you were there.
Yeah.
So again, Rod Roddenberry, CEO of Roddenberry Entertainment. Thanks a lot, Rod. And, you know, I always say it, you're always welcome on here.
Oh, thank you so much. And thank you for the opportunity to share this. I look forward to seeing everyone who's listening at WonderCon. Please come by and say hi. I'm sure after the panel, if we'll have a good Q&A. If you have any questions and they don't get answered, I usually just hang out outside afterwards. So just come up and ask any questions, and they could be about anything. And if you have any insults, go ahead and throw those at me too. I'm good with all of it.
Yeah, he's got a thick skin, so don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rod. We'll see you at WonderCon.
Thanks, guys. Take care.
The Geek Speak Show will be right back.
The folks behind Comic-Con in San Diego now bring you WonderCon in Anaheim. Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. WonderCon guests include Jim Lee, Mike Mignola, J. Michael Straczynski, Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum, Emma Stone, and Alexander Skarsgård, plus TV and movie sneak peeks. WonderCon has comic book publishers, gaming, a masquerade, and more. WonderCon, Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. For info, visit WonderCon.org. That's WonderCon.org.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
We're back on the Geek Speak Show.
Don't be too proud of this technological terror you've constructed.
Hello, we're back on the Geek Speak Show. So, Violet, you're new. You haven't gone through this yet. Every time we do anything Star Trek related, we just talk to Rod Roddenberry. Uh-huh. We always get emails. Well, I do at least. I don't know about you yet, but I always get emails saying, hey, you always do Star Trek. What about Star Wars? Well, I had a little thing for Ralph McQuarrie in the beginning. That was Star Wars. Now we did Star Trek. Now, here's some more Star Wars stuff for you.
Oh, I'm excited.
It's not actually part of WonderCon, but you can take a little break from WonderCon, and it's literally about 10 minutes away from the convention center. And that is a very, very cool, very geeky, and very cool exhibit. It's called Star Wars, where science meets imagination. Told you we had some Star Wars coming
that
up for you.
That sounds exciting.
Yeah, it is. And you go to our link section. It's all up on there. You can get the tickets, everything else. But let's hear all about it from product coordinator. I can't talk now. Coordinator Emily Robertson.
You're too excited.
Yeah, I am actually. Welcome to the Geek Speak Show.
Great. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming on. So tell us all about the exhibit, Star Wars, where science meets imagination.
Sure. Well, this is an exhibit that we at the Museum of Science in Boston produced in collaboration with Lucasfilm. And it's an exhibition that has been traveling around the world since 2006 when it went on the road. And it is now on display at the Discovery Science Center in Santa Ana, as you just mentioned. And it's an exhibition that's actually takes the Star Wars sort of film universe and kind of juxtaposes it against the real world of engineering and engineering design. And it gets visitors to think about if they could build a universe that's like the Star Wars universe in the real world, how would they do it? And so it's a mixture of artifacts from all of the six Star Wars films. They are the actual props and costumes and models that were used in the filming. And then it also has a lot of interactive activities that get visitors to think about engineering design and new technologies and imagining a future that's like the Star Wars universe.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, it's temporary. So what are the dates for the exhibit?
Sure. Yes, it is a temporary exhibit. It's an exhibit that travels around the country, and it will be in Santa Ana, California, at Discovery Science Center through April 15th of this year. So, closing in just a few weeks.
So, those of you who will be there this weekend for WonderCon, you have a chance to see it. And again, just go to discoverycube.org. That is where you can get all the information, ticket prices, hours, all that stuff. It's all on there, up on our links section. And we are talking to Emily Robertson, product coordinator for Star Wars, where science meets imagination. And Star Wars has always been described, especially by George Lucas, has been described as a space fantasy. Who and how did they make the connection, you know, fantasy to today's sciences? Who made that connection?
Well, there actually have been a lot of real scientists and researchers over the years since the first film came out in 1977 who have been inspired to become those scientists and those researchers and engineers in their real lives by watching the films and getting excited about creating things that they saw in the films. And we, you know, heard about them and decided that this would make a great exhibit topic. And so we ended up getting connected with Lucasfilm, and they loved the idea as well. They love educational opportunities, and they look at this as a great opportunity to, you know, kind of get the brand out there in a different way. And so that's sort of how we made that connection. And it's a really easy connection to make because there are a lot of things that you see in the films that many of these scientists and researchers today are trying to do in real life. For example, robotics. Many of them were inspired by R2-D2 and C-3PO, and we've been able to make a lot of advances in robotics by what we've seen on screen.
Yeah, so a lot like Star Trek, Star Wars and Star Trek, they both became an actual science fact rather than just science fiction.
In a lot of ways, yeah. I mean, there are a lot of things that we see in Star Wars that are fantasy that we wouldn't be able to do in the real world. But there are other things that, you know, we might be able to do, like Luke's land speeder. In fact, you can see Luke's real land speeder in the exhibit, one that was used during the filming. And there are activities around it that get visitors to think about how they might build a vehicle that floats in the real world and how they might do that, what technologies and what types of engineering would they use to do that. They might build a hovercraft, or they might use electromagnetism, and there are activities where you can actually test that out.
So I was just wondering, I'd heard that you guys had the speeder and droid building. How old should you, I guess, be to participate in that, or is there like no age limit, or just like...
Well, we designed the exhibit to be really, in terms of the educational goals that we were reaching, mm-hmm. we designed it to be probably about 6 or 7 years old and up. And so that means that the activities sort of make the most impact for those ages and older. It doesn't mean that if you're 5, you can't participate. and it's really meant for everybody. And families certainly come in and use the exhibit really well. It's definitely made for families, and it's made for groups. And so it's nice. Sometimes you can see families working together. You might have a really young child working with their parent, building one of the magnetic little speeder cars that we have in the exhibit and getting them to float down the track. There's a lot of interaction that can go on. And so it's sort of fun for everybody. But in terms of educationally, it's really for those ages and up.
Yeah, build your own pod racer, all that stuff there. it's called Star Wars, Where Science Meets Imagination, happening right now till April 15th at the Discovery Science Center, just 10 minutes away from the Anaheim Convention Center. Not part of WonderCon, but when you guys want to take a little break from WonderCon and all that stuff that's happening there, take a little drive or a walk over there. It is kind of within walking distance, and take check it out. I got to say, one of the biggest draws there has to be the Millennium Falcon experience.
Yes, I would say generally that's one of the exhibit's biggest draws, probably
in
every city that we go to. the Millennium Falcon experience is one of my favorite parts also. What it is essentially is it's a full-size replica of the cockpit of the Millennium Falcon. So it's not the whole Falcon, it's just a replica of the cockpit.
Just the important part.
Yeah, very important. Sometimes visitors get disappointed. They might hear that, we've got the whole thing and we don't. It's just the cockpit. but it's still great. And essentially you go and you can sit inside the cockpit and you get to watch a 4.5-minute multimedia presentation. And you sit in special seats that have special kind of audio components built into them to give you a really full surround sound experience. And it actually, you get to go on a ride to the edge of the universe and back. And it's narrated by Anthony Daniels, who played C-3PO in the films. And it's a wonderful experience. You get to feel like you're really sitting inside the cockpit of the actual Falcon. Very, very fun.
Okay, that's it. We're going. And Violet, you want to be Chewbacca or Han Solo?
What, do I look like Chewbacca?
Do I need to answer that? So yeah, you guys definitely, you got to try this out. You've always wanted to be, and really, we're being funny here, but a lot of people have always had that fantasy is, I want to be Han Solo, I want to be piloting the Millennium Falcon.
No, I completely understand.
You can experience it there.
Yeah, I think for any fan, it's really not to be missed. And people should know that the tickets, I'm pretty sure, are first come, first serve for the Millennium Falcon. It's a separate ticket than the exhibit. So I think if you really want to go to it, I would try to go earlier in the day. And it's $5 with the general admission for the Millennium Falcon experience, because it is in a separate building from the rest of the exhibit.
Yeah.
So as you're saying, this was like a joint project with Lucasfilm, right?
That's right. Yep. Yeah. The Museum of Science at Boston produced it with Lucasfilm in a collaborative project. Yeah.
And has anyone from Lucasfilm got to like go to the exhibit and experience the whole thing?
Yeah. Many people have actually. We hosted all different model makers and different filmmakers at different times. They've come out and seen it in different cities. And we worked very closely with them to give a really accurate and sort of true Star Wars experience, something that's really true to the universe.
Mm-hmm.
And they really helped us a great deal in getting that to happen. It's been a lot of fun working with them.
Has Mr. Lucas had a chance to experience it?
He has, yeah. He came out to see the exhibit when it premiered in Boston in 2005.
What did he think?
He loved it, as far as I know. He got to tour around it and really enjoyed it. It was actually been a great experience, you know, being able to do this, doing something that's, really, it's a very kind of unique way of looking at the films.
Yeah, so again, we're talking to Emily Robertson, product coordinator, specifically for Star Wars, Where Science Meets Imagination. It's going on right now through April 15th at the Discovery Center in Anaheim, I guess it would be. But it is like 10 minutes away from the Anaheim Convention Center. So those of you, when you need to, like I said, calm down, take a little break from all this WonderCon stuff, perfect place to go is sit in the Millennium Falcon cockpit. What better way to take a break from WonderCon? And you mentioned, Emily, that it is a traveling exhibit. So where can we see it next?
So next, it will be at Exploration Place in Wichita, Kansas, and that will be over Memorial Day weekend and running through the summer through Labor Day.
Okay. And is that it, or is there any plans to take it anywhere else?
Yep. After that, after it leaves Kansas, it will go to Orlando, Florida in the fall to the Orlando Science Center. And then after that, we have a little while left on the tour, a few more spots to fill, but we haven't determined all those places yet. But we will be announcing them when we figure them out on our website, which is mos.org/StarWars. That's where our main schedule is. And so hopefully we'll be able to determine those in the next few months.
Do you have any plans to bring it down to the Bay Area?
You know, we haven't quite figured out where we're going to be bringing it, but we're looking at all the different sort of sections of the country that we haven't been to mm-hmm. yet.
I can tell by the look on your face because it is Star Wars. I mean, the Bay Area is considered sort of the unofficial home of Star Wars since yep. George Lucas is here and everything.
Sure.
So it would make sense.
To you.
Plus, yeah, we really want to ride in the Millennium Falcon over here.
Again.
So again, it's called Star Wars, Where Science Meets Imagination. Very awesome. And I know all of you just stop listening at the Rent of the Millennium Falcon experience. You're on there getting your tickets. Again, it's on our link section. Go on there. Operating hours, tickets. It is a separate ticketed event, the Millennium Falcon experience. So go there early and get your tickets. And Emily, thanks a lot for coming on. And you're welcome back anytime if you come closer. Or even if you just want to talk about anything else, you're more than welcome to come back on the show.
Excellent. Well, thanks for having me.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.
The Geek Speak Show will be right back.
The folks behind Comic-Con in San Diego now bring you WonderCon in Anaheim. Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. WonderCon guests include
Jim Lee, Mike Mignola, J. Michael Straczynski, Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum, Emma Stone, and Alexander Skarsgård,
plus TV and movie sneak peeks. WonderCon has comic book publishers, gaming, a masquerade, and more. WonderCon, Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. For info, visit WonderCon.org. That's WonderCon.org.
Tell the world about that great book you just finished reading or read when you were younger. Send an email to books@thegeekspeakshow.com and your book will be featured on the weekly book club segment. Just a few rules. 1. The book must be in the sci-fi, horror, or fantasy genre.
Or a mashup of those. 2.
Biographies are okay as long as it's relevant to geek culture. You know, George Lucas, Stan Lee, Steve Jobs, etc., etc.
3.
No comic books, but graphic novels are okay.
4.
You must have read the book and loved it. Don't suggest a book just because my friend's cousin, sister's boyfriend's dad said it was good. And that's it. Send your suggestions to books@thegeekspeakshow.com and you might hear your book mentioned on next week's show. If possible, we might even have the writer on to talk about the book. books@thegeekspeakshow.com to have your book featured on the Geek Speak Show Book Club.
And now here's the Geek Speak Show Book Club. Here's Henry and Romo.
Well, just me for now. Henry, hey, how's it going? Let's calm down just a little bit. Let's cool down on the warm-up, the WonderCon show. Had a lot of special guests, a lot more coming up. And you'll see them. You can go to our YouTube page. All the coverage will be there all weekend long. Video interviews with all the big guests at WonderCon 2012 happening this weekend in Anaheim. But you know that because we've been talking about it all show. So I do have a pick for the Geek Speak Book Club this week, and it is a a book that's pretty appropriate, actually, for WonderCon, what we're going to see there. Those of you who are going to be there this weekend, you're going to be inundated with marketing. Marketing for TV shows, for movies, video games, books, comic books, graphic novels, all kinds of stuff. But how do we heard about this last week from Doug Neff a little bit, from how you go to from fan to creator. Now, once you've got it up there, how do you market it? Well, somebody actually wrote a book about it. It's called Creating Blockbusters, How to Generate and Market Hit Entertainment for TV, Movies, Video Games, and Books. It's written by Gene Delvecchio. Gene's on the phone with us right now. Gene, welcome to the Geek Speak Show.
Thank you very much, Henry. It's a pleasure to be on.
Pleasure to have you here. So before we get into the book, let's have you tell everybody, what qualifies you to write a book about creating blockbusters?
I have been working in and around the entertainment industry for 30 years. In fact, when I started, I still had hair on my head, and now it's all gone. I started, though, at an advertising agency that was working on the Paramount Pictures business for about a decade. I was also working not just on the Paramount Pictures business, but also Mattel Toys, when they were translating a lot of the Disney films into toys. So what I was doing on Paramount business was to helping to support our media group, understand the target audience. Who are those people out there? What are they looking for in films? How do we connect with them? How do we reach them? On the Mattel side, what we were doing was to translate again those films from Disney and others into toys. But I was tasked with understanding what is it that kids are looking for in entertainment, what was the real appealing element of some of these great films, and how did we encapsulate it in 30 seconds so that kids would understand not only the film but how it translates into merchandise. Now, about 15 years ago, I went out on my own, having written my first book, and I've been working in the entertainment industry ever since with a number of companies. I've tested, for example, well over 100 new TV shows, a slew of films, always talking to audiences with respect to what are they looking for in entertainment, what is it about this film, this script, this idea that entices them, and then how do we make sure it comes to fruition in the way they want, and how do we make sure that they market it in a way that sort of captures the attention of audiences everywhere. But I should tell you, I'm not just a researcher trying to look for what audiences are looking for. I'm also a novelist. So I've written a couple of fantasy novels, one of which was recommended by the American Library Association. Another one got an award by the International Reading Association. Guy, a research geek. I am also a storyteller. So I know how to translate what audiences are asking for into the storytelling medium. So it's 30 years worth of understanding audiences and helping to translate it into story and to marketing.
Yeah, so obviously Gene knows what he's talking about, or in this case, written about. So tell me, Gene, without getting into too many, on this show we don't get into spoilers and give away things too much. We do want people to go out and see the blockbusters, or in your case, buy the book and read it. But what exactly does make a blockbuster, whether movie, video game, or whatever it is?
Well, I can't go through all the principles because there are too many of them, but there are about 11 principles to connect with. Let me give you a couple of those. And I'll start with the most important, which is it needs to connect with the deep emotional need that audiences have. Now, that sounds obvious. I mean, any screenwriter is going to tell you, anyone developing a story-based video game is going to say, you have to, like, go to the jugular. The problem is most don't do that. They think they do, but they don't. In the research that I actually conducted for the book, I asked 400 audience members to tell me, when you have a hero in a story, a protagonist in the story, what are the key goals that this protagonist has to achieve? And it's things that you would expect. For example, some things are like survival. That came up number one. About 53% said it's got to have a survival theme. It has to have a character being brave. Here's one that many stories actually missed. It has to have a character that fulfills their full potential. Meaning going from a lower level, like, oh, he can't do it, he's never going to succeed, into a higher level, yes, he finally did it. Now, a lot of stories think they do that. Most don't. But if you look at stories in the classic Star Wars, where Luke Skywalker, very young, doesn't have the skills, but little by little he achieves those skills so that finally, at the very end, he's powerful enough, strong enough to take on Darth Vader. That's the kinds of elements that they're looking for. But there are other things like redemption stories, gaining respect along the way. All these are core emotional drivers that the best of the best films, they connect with all of them. Not just one or two, but all of them. Then there are other principles. You have to align with contemporary culture and trends. You think of the way that Avatar, for example, had an environmental theme. because we care about the environment more than ever before. Even the Monopoly board game, think about it. It was created during the Great Depression when people needed a get-rich-quick fantasy. If you look at The Simpsons, they're always connecting with trends in pop culture. Mm-hmm. So it's about emotional needs. It's about making sure you develop something that connects with trends in pop culture. It's about making sure you have aspiring characters. And there are other elements, like building in elements to make sure that you connect with broad appeal, male, female, younger, and older. And in the book, I go through all the elements you need to do to do that. But you also have to build in elements that make it a franchise. Many times I'll be reading scripts, and I'll look at them, and I'll say, but I got it. It's a great story idea, but where's the environment that's going to lead to a toy line? Where's the kind of character that has the personality, the possessions, and the appearance as such to help lead to even apparel or video games, even food products? So there are many elements that blockbusters have. Again, there are 11 of them in total. Don't have the time to go through all of them. But when the idea builds these in, you're more likely to have a great success.
Yeah, all you guys can find out about those 11 principles that Gene just mentioned when the book comes out. And the book is called Creating Blockbusters, How to Generate and Market Hit Entertainment for TV, Movies, Video Games, and Books. And actually, Gene, while you were mentioning those principles right now, something came to mind, and let me throw that out at you, is a lot of people have this complaint at WonderCon, especially at Comic-Con, that too many films today are too commercial, they say. And like you mentioned right now, but you do have to have that tie into the foods, the T-shirts, the, you know, all that stuff, the action figures. Can a movie suffer too much if they focus too much on that?
No, actually not at all. But you think of the term commercial, and I've dealt with this, by the way, for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
What actually is commercial? And let me bring it back to like a toy line for a moment. If you have a doll that a little girl loves, everyone says, great, she should be able to hug the doll, and that would be great, helps her sleep at night. If that doll, however, came from a franchise, okay, from a movie, and all of a sudden she has a teddy bear, koala bear, whatever it might be that she hugs at night, people will say, wait a minute, that's commercial. But then you have to stop back and say, well, wait a minute, it's not commercial. That particular toy is fulfilling a need in the child's life. If you look at Star Wars, for example, as another great example, Star Wars sold about 5 times as much merchandise as it did box office tickets. Why? Because kids not only wanted to see the film, they wanted to play it out, imaginative play, creating their own stories, extending the franchise. These are all extremely powerful things. And the only reason that works, and this is critical, the only reason that works is because consumers want it. So some people can step back and say, oh, that's far too commercial. But on the other hand, as long as audiences were interested enough to partake in it, it means that it fulfilled an emotional need, whether it be a wand from Harry Potter or a lightsaber from Star Wars. It fulfilled emotional needs. Is it commercial? That means it makes money, sure. Did it fulfill an emotional need? Yes, it did. So why should it be prevented? It's like saying, let's take that little koala bear away from the child because it came from a movie. That's silly. As long as it means something to the child, something to the adult, it makes sense to have it. And the best thing, by the way, consumers can do is that if they think it's too commercial, which means they don't want it, is don't buy. Because that's the best message they could send to a studio, that the studio for that franchise has hit the limit in terms of what audiences want.
Yeah, in fact, what is a surefire audience killer, things that will definitely turn an audience away?
Well, I asked the respondents in a nationwide study, again, for the book, in terms of when they turn away from a potential blockbuster or any film, any story-based video game, any story-based novel, you name it, what are the key things that kill it? And here are their pet peeves. 59% said the story was boring. Now, in part, you could say, well, maybe that had to do with the action or not enough humor. But I think what a lot of the audience members were saying was they didn't like the story to begin with, which is fascinating because when you think of the way studios run, they often create an idea, they push the idea into development, they've now spent tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions, on developing a film, and only then do they say, now let's bring it to audiences to see what they think, as a pre-survey before we actually market it. Many times the idea was wrong to begin with, and they shouldn't have actually gone forward on greenlighting a number of these ideas because the idea wasn't enticing enough. So number one thing audiences say, it's the story. Many of the stories, they just don't connect. Why did they even produce these things? 44% said that the thing didn't interest them from the start, so it was very slow starts. You had about 47% saying the action wasn't there. You had about 40% saying it wasn't funny enough. 50%, get this, this is fat, 50% said, you know, the whole idea, the whole thing was just stupid, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
So there are many pet peeves that audiences have, but many times it comes back to the story was stupid to begin with, the action wasn't there, the kind of action I wanted, the humor wasn't there. And for kids, you also see very high scores for it was just too confusing. Too many twists and turns, too many knots in the story, they just couldn't follow it. And by the way, that happens for adults too.
Yeah. And actually, we talked to a lot of directors and producers and actors even on the show, and a lot of the scriptwriters and the directors, they all say also having characters that you care about is another important thing.
Yeah, there's a very high percent of respondents who actually said that the characters were either not relatable enough or aspiring enough, and that's very critical. In fact, if you go back to what made Spider-Man great. Peter Parker was a teenager, right? And,
yeah.
And that was actually new for the time when the comic book was created. But you could relate to him as a teenager. You said, I feel like I am him. And on the other hand, because he rose to greatness, he had a power you could aspire towards. Some characters are relatable but not aspirational. Some are aspirational, but they're not relatable. Peter Parker, Spider-Man, hit that perfect note. And that's why it worked.
Yeah, we're talking to Gene Delvecchio. He wrote a book called Creating Blockbusters, How to Generate and Market Hit Entertainment for TV, Movies, Video Games, and Books. Go to the book club section on our GeekSpeakRadioShow.com webpage. It's all on there. Links to you can get the book on there, and you can see Gene. He'll talk a little bit more about the book. But don't go there now. Keep listening to the interview right now. But Gene, let me ask you this. What made, for example, Green Lantern was supposed to be the big blockbuster last year, and so was Cowboys and Aliens, but they failed at the box office and little kind of quiet. There was trailers, but Rise of the Planet of the Apes became a huge hit. Why that happened?
Fascinating, huh?
Yeah.
In part, it's expectations. And let me give you an idea. And you may already know some of these numbers. Cowboys and Aliens did about $175 million or so at the box office. Now, worldwide. In most cases, people would say, well, that's a blockbuster, right?
Yeah.
Did almost $200 million. Wow! Well, the problem with Cowboys and Aliens, and it's one of the same problems with Green Lantern, and this is even before I get to the story, because I'm going to talk to the story in a moment, is that their production expenses were so great, because the expectations were so great, that they couldn't overcome the financial hole that they dug. Cowboys and Aliens was about $163 million just to produce. When you add marketing on top of that, it probably came close to $200 million. So they only did $174 worldwide, and the studio only gets half of that, so that was a big financial hole. Green Lantern, $200 million to produce, add the marketing on top of that, it could have come close to maybe $275 million or so.
Mm-hmm.
It only did about $220 worldwide. So both of them were deemed failures because there was a financial issue. But they also missed in sort of interesting ways. If you look at Cowboys and Aliens, it had trouble attracting a younger audience.
Yeah.
In fact, about 63% of the film went to people over age 30. So you look at that and you say, it was sort of this Western thing. Maybe a lot of younger kids couldn't connect with it. It didn't have enough of the alien stuff that they love. And then the stars were older. I mean, these were stars that a lot of the audiences couldn't connect with. So there were some fundamental issues that were going on with Cowboys and Aliens, independent of even what the story was. It was also, I mean, in my opinion, It didn't have the grit as a true grit had. It didn't have that grittiness of like cowboy,
mm-hmm.
and it didn't have the fantastic alien sequences that I think audiences have come to expect. If you look at different films, for example, let's go back to the financial part. $163 million to make Cowboys and Aliens. Super 8 was about $50
million. Mm-hmm.
True Grit, which is on the other side, the more the cowboy part, $38 million. If Cowboys and Aliens had been made for that much, you and I would be talking about what a huge success it was.
Right.
It's financial. Green Lantern had the same kind of financial issue. I personally like Green Lantern. I don't know what you thought. It had the Brotherhood sworn to save the intergalactic peace. It had the new recruit from Earth. I think it was beat up probably a bit more than I would have beaten it up. In my mind, it lacks sort of a grittiness, a realism to it. But other than that, I wouldn't have been as damning on it as a lot of people in the industry have been. Planet of the Apes had things going for it. The other two did not. First, its cost structure was better. It was about $93 million or so, and it made about $480 million or so worldwide. So it didn't have the financial burden the other two had. But it also had a lot of the emotional drivers I was talking about earlier. It had the survival theme with the ape, being put in jeopardy. It had a lot of compassion in it with the scientists trying to save the apes. It had that whole notion of trying to fulfill a full potential, which in this case had to do with the character Caesar rising to greatness. But it had another thing that maybe the other two did not. It answered a question about the franchise that people always wondered about, which was, how in the heck did it all start?
Yeah.
How did the Earth become like apes? And they did a brilliant thing with the storyline.
Yeah, I was going to say, it made perfect sense, too.
Oh, the virus that created the apes' intelligence also decimated, at the very end of the film, you can see how it was decimating the human race.
Yeah.
It was just seamless. So what it did, it created, and I talk about not only expanding audiences, but also this whole notion of Evercool. It helped reinvent the franchise in a very interesting way that the other movies did not do. It helped answer the question, what happened? How did this come to be? But it did two things. It said for older audiences, come back to the franchise, because we're going to tell you now. But it also introduced itself to a whole new audience of today's kids who didn't even know about or didn't know much about Planet of the Apes. So it hit the perfect note emotionally, in terms of trends, and in terms of older and younger audiences.
Yeah, on this show we talked about it when it was first announced, and this audience, myself included in that, we still had a kind of a bad taste from the Tim Burton version of Planet of the Apes not too long ago.
Yes.
And
yes, yes.
I've always loved the original franchise with Charlton Heston. I own them on Blu-ray. I love those, and like you said, the emotional tie was there. So I went to see it on opening day, kind of wary, but was pleasantly surprised.
It also had something, which was the use of the performance capture technique.
Yeah.
They made the ape look real. I mean, Caesar felt real. And that in and of itself helps entice people in, because they say, that's really a great technique. Look what they're doing with it. I want to come see. In fact, the one who was brilliant of that, and he's done that multiple times now, is James Cameron, what he did with Avatar. James Cameron got more PR with the performance capture technique than he did with the story of the film of Avatar itself. And it's one of the things that I talk about in a chapter called Marketable Artistry, and that is, how do you create something and market something that people will be interested to see from the get-go? Well, performance capture is one way to go, but it was certainly applied in the context of Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah, and I still think it's a travesty that Andy Serkis wasn't nominated for anything, but hey.
I know. I mean, it's crazy. I love big blockbusters, and you look at Harry Potter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it should have gotten some award. It did $1.3 billion last year, the final installment of Harry Potter. It didn't get nothing. It didn't even get anything for special effects. I mean, it's amazing the way the Academy Award people vote. But that's, I guess, another topic.
Yeah, speaking of, and this has nothing to do with the book, in Planet of the Apes, do you think Draco is going to be known as Draco in every role he takes from now on?
It could be.
Yeah, because in Planet of the Apes, he was just Draco with an American accent.
Right. Yes. It could be.
Yeah. Another thing is two big hits that we had recently were two R-rated films, which usually you don't really consider them as blockbusters, except for like the Die Hards and all those. But Kick-Ass and Attack the Block last year, real surprise, were really big. But is there such a thing as too gratuitous a movie?
Let me step back a moment. Kick-Ass is one of my favorite all-time movies,
mm-hmm.
but I'm also its biggest critic, and I'll tell you why. I'm not even sure it broke even, by the way. It had a production budget, I'm looking at numbers here, of about $30 million, if this is correct. It did about $96 million worldwide. But if you tack on the marketing money to the production budget, and you divide the worldwide money by half, which is all that the studio gets, it might have broken even, but not sure. I love Kick-Ass. I think it works on multiple categories. It's about survival. It's about love and belonging. You have self-esteem. You have characters trying to achieve full potential. It's the team you can relate to. On the other hand, he's aspirational. It has everything you want.
Right.
But in my book, I actually say it's a miss, and I'll tell you why. I think it could have doubled its box office easily, doubled its box office, and it had to do with the R rating. The problem, I think, with the R rating is while it allowed it to have the grittiness, the language, the violence that fanboys would love,
mm-hmm.
It turned away many more of the younger audiences who couldn't get in, who would have loved this idea.
Yeah.
If it were me, I would have dialed this back to a PG-13, the way the Dark Knight was a PG-13. Still gritty, still realistic, but I think it could have greatly expanded the audience for people who would have wanted to see the character of Kick-Ass, and in particular, Hit Girl.
Yeah.
Hit Girl was fantastic. I think that instead of doing $96 million, this could have done $200 million worldwide, my personal belief. Still on a production budget of $30 million. But sometimes what the filmmakers will do, and I'm assuming this, I may not be right, but that they will create a movie for a smaller audience of fanboys. We have to make the fanboys happy. But think of it this way. If there are a million fanboys who really love Kick-Ass, at $10 a ticket, that's only $10 million
yeah.
in box office receipts. Unless you try to expand it to a broader audience, it's never going to work. I think Kick-Ass is one of the best movies, action movies for heroes, but it missed because it should have been rated, in my belief, PG-13 and not rated R, and it could have done so much better. It would have had so many more followers. Attack of the Block I didn't see,
okay.
So let me put that up front. I have seen the trailers for Attack of the Block.
Mm-hmm.
If the numbers I'm looking at are right, and I'm looking at numbers that say it was $13 million to make, but it only did about not even $6 million worldwide.
Yeah, it wasn't in limited release, too, so that may have something to do with it.
I think so, too. So it really was a niche film for a very finite audience.
Yeah.
I like the idea of what I've seen of these kids in London being attacked by aliens. They fight back. What I didn't care for, which I think could have done better, I thought the production values were poor.
Mm-hmm.
Relative to what people are used to. Just, again, my opinion. I also didn't feel there was a human interest story. What's interesting is a comparison if you make Attack of the Block to Super 8.
Mm-hmm.
Super 8 had a human interest story.
Yeah.
It was a group of kids, very same kind of thing, but there was a boy who had to defend his town, save his girl. I didn't get that from the trailers I saw for Attack of the Block. It was a group of kids who had to defend their block, but it wasn't an individual human interest story. And the other thing was the production values. I mean, get a load of this. Super 8 was about $50 million to make. It was four times what it took to make Attack of the Block. But it made 45 times the worldwide box office.
Hmm.
I think that had a lot to do with, A, production values, but, B, it was a more human interest story. And I think, and even though Attack of the Block got a lot of press, it got a lot of, not so much press, it got a lot of stuff floating around the internet, I thought it was a great, great attempt, but in my mind, I thought it missed.
Yeah, but I've seen it, I own that one too. That was my surprise last year as one of the biggest hits. It does have one thing that you mentioned on earlier. And that is the going from sort of like the loser to the winner. It does have that in some of the characters. I won't give too much away. Those of you who have seen it, you know what I'm talking about. But it does have that element in Attack the Block.
I think that's great. But I will tell you, I saw no marketing for it.
Yeah.
So this is another issue, and I talk about it in the book. I mean, sometimes fail because it's a great idea, but nobody's spending enough money in order to promote it to the right audiences. So I saw no marketing whatsoever for it. And that could have been part of the problem. If what you say is true and you think it has a lot of the components there, then maybe that was another missed opportunity. What I actually do in the book, I say unless you're spending a certain amount of money to get the awareness out, you might as well not be spending anything. Because if you spend, and I'm just going to throw out a number, if you spend $5 million on marketing, that's nothing in today's world. People won't hear it at all. It's like you have to spend a certain threshold before people start to be aware of a film. To understand it, appreciate it, to know what's going on. So it could be that it was a woeful lack of marketing, but without knowing more about Attack of the Block, I can't be sure.
Yeah, and those of us who will be there this weekend at WonderCon in Anaheim, we're going to see a lot of money being spent on marketing there. Now, this may be considered cheating a little bit, now that, especially once the book comes out. The book, by the way, is called Creating Blockbusters, How to Generate and Market Hit Entertainment for TV, Movies, Video Games, and Books. Gene Devlucky, the author, he's on with us right now. What should we look out for in the marketing this weekend at WonderCon? So we know, hey, they're doing it right.
You're going to be inundated with a lot of marketing components.
Yeah.
Most of these is going to be pushed, of course, with the trailer, because the trailer is everything. It encapsulates the idea. I think as you look at these, you have to say to yourself, what is the emotional story here? Is it just a lot of scenes that look like a lot of action, or do you get a sense of a character? They're a great goal, and they're great challenges. A lot of action films, they miss because they don't do that. They just show a lot of action scenes. In fact, one of the people that provided some insights for the book, her comment was, sometimes in action movies, and she's very much involved in putting together trailers and media, she goes, a lot of times in action movies, they spend so much time on the action scenes that they're not spending enough on the story. So when it's time to actually build a trailer that says, here's the character, here's the great goal, here's the great challenges, there's nothing there to show. So when you look at trailers, you have to say to yourself, is it a mini story? Do you get the sense of the character again, his great goal and challenges, what he has to overcome in order to reach something? Is there an emotional issue of survival, great love, great loss, great challenges? If that's missing, then it's missed. Now, in terms of the things I would love to see, because I'm going to be there one of the days. Hobbit, I want to see how that's coming. I've already seen a number of the trailers on The Hobbit. I think they look pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Avengers, of course. Spider-Man, Battleship. The one I'm most interested in, though, to tell you the truth, is Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated to see how this sort of comes together as a mashup, because if you look at some of the other mashups that have been created, like Cowboys and Aliens, they disappointed a bit. Some people can't wrap their brain around two very separate things being brought into one woven story. So I'm very curious to see how Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, sort of comes together in the marketing materials. But, again, key characters, what's the goal, what's the emotional story, those kinds of elements you want to look for to see if the story itself knows what it's doing, knows where it's headed.
Yeah, for this year, I think those movies that you mentioned are definitely going to be blockbusters, especially The Dark Knight Rises when that comes. I think, and it's going to be at WonderCon, I think a quiet one, not too quiet, but it's been a little bit quiet, is Prometheus. I think that's going to be a big hit, too.
You know, I think you're right. I just saw the trailer for the first time. I was in the theater the other day to see John Carter, and I think that's where I saw the Prometheus trailer. And I was very taken by Prometheus trailer because, you know, it's one of those things very similar maybe to Rise of the Planet of the Apes. It's a nice prequel.
Yeah.
It's like, how did it come to be? How did Prometheus come to be? So I think it's an opportunity to capture not only older audiences but also younger ones as well. The other ones I'm looking forward to, I mean, and you meant like The Hunger Games, of course, Men in Black 3 I think is going to be great, Twilight I think is going to be great. But the other one I'm looking forward to is Brave.
Mm-hmm. Just Pixar's new one?
Yeah, I'm interested to see how that's going to do and how that sort of comes to life. And call me crazy, Three Stooges.
You know what? Me too, because I'm a big Three Stooges fan, and I do want to see what they're going to do with it.
Me too, because you know it's one of those stories, characters, whatever. Where way back when I grew up with this stuff, and I would love to see this be reintroduced to our kids.
Yeah.
I would love for them to cherish the Three Stooges. And I did see the trailers for Three Stooges, at least one of the trailers for Three Stooges. It looks hilarious, and I think they captured the personalities of the three characters themselves. So part of me, it's emotional. I just hope it does well because it was so great in the past. So it can be reintroduced to a new generation of audience members who I think will love the old slapstick comedy.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. Like I said, I have a lot of the old Stooges on DVD and love it also myself. So really looking forward to that one also. So Gene Del Vecchio, his book is called Creating Blockbusters, How to Generate and Market Hit Entertainment for TV, Movies, Video Games, and Books. The book is coming soon. When is it going to be in stores, Gene?
It just got shipped. And it's now starting to show up in stores, and it's now finally in stock at Amazon.com as of today. So it finally made it to Amazon.
Okay, and you guys can just go on our book link section on the website, and it's all on there, a link for you guys to get it. So definitely this will show you what to look for the next time you get inundated at WonderCon, at Comic-Con, or just get trailers when you go to your local movie theater. Gene, thanks a lot for coming on. You're welcome back anytime.
Thank you very much for having me, Henry, and good luck at WonderCon.
Yeah, maybe we'll run into each other.
Maybe we will.
Okay, thanks, Jim.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
The Geek Speak Show will be right back.
The folks behind Comic-Con in San Diego now bring you WonderCon in Anaheim. Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. WonderCon guests include
Jim Lee, Mike Mignola, J. Michael Straczynski, Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum, Emma Stone, and Alexander Skarsgård.
Plus TV and movie sneak peeks.
WonderCon has comic book publishers, gaming, a masquerade, and more. WonderCon, Friday through Sunday, March 16th through 18th at the Anaheim Convention Center. For info, visit WonderCon.org. That's WonderCon.org. O-R-G.
Now back to the Geek Speak Show.
Oh, hello. That's us, huh?
Yes, that's us.
That's Violet. I'm me.
Me? That's a funny name.
I know. Parents were comedians. So welcome back to the Geek Speak Show. I'm Henry. That's Violet getting ready. Now we're really ready. We're done with the show. Told you guys, those of you who went through the whole show, doesn't it feel like you were there at WonderCon? It hasn't even happened yet.
I'm excited.
Yeah, you're still excited about Doug Neff? You really want to see that one?
I really, 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 really want to see that one.
She's not kidding. He really did inspire her last week when he was on with us. So that will be the first panel, actually, on Saturday. What are you looking forward to as we get ready to say bye-bye? What are you looking forward to seeing or being a part of this weekend?
Besides Doug Neff?
Yes.
So a little excited. I really, really want to go see that 360-degree. I mean, it won't be in a planetarium, but it still sounds really cool.
Yeah, but it's a Roddenberry thing. It always has, and mm-hmm. he mentioned it has a little twist, so we mm-hmm. like those kind of things. That's why I like J.J. Abrams stuff. I'm looking for all this stuff here. I have it all written down. We haven't really planned things.
You guys can't see it, but he's got like stacks of paper.
Oh, yeah, huh? Here. You can hear it. yeah, but a bunch of stuff. We're going to do a lot of video interviews. And so even, not just this show, but even if you can't go, yes, San Franciscans, we hear you, we read you. It's not in San Francisco. What do I do? Well, couple of things. You heard it from David Glanzer. You can nicely contact the Moscone Center and say, can you please give them a date or dates for next year? Because as of right now, you heard David say, as of right now, there's going to be no WonderCon here next year either. And it's not them, not their decision. It's a word I can never say. But Moscone Center, they haven't given them any dates. So
maybe we'll write a letter together to them.
Yes. Okay. What do you call those things? Form letters or chain letters? No, don't chain yourself to the... don't occupy Moscone. Don't do that because then it'll really never happen. Uh-huh. But just be nice and say, hey, please give them some dates because we really like WonderCon. We like the event. We'll be there. We'll spend money there and hopefully it'll happen. So I am looking forward to a lot of things. But Friday usually is the light day. Everybody knows it happens like that here. But I'm really mm-hmm. looking forward to the OneRing.net panel because mm-hmm. I'm sure they're going to talk about a little movie that's coming in December. Peter Jackson's one. Directing. Yeah, has something to do with a ring. Not the Lord of the Rings, The Hobbit. An unexpected journey. So they'll probably talk about that. So looking forward to that one. Also looking for my new BFF, Chris Hardwick. He's got his panel, the Nerdist panel. We met up and had a fun time with him at Image. He's going to unveil the lineup for his new YouTube channel. So can't wait for that. And we mm-hmm. may have some surprises that have to do with this very show, as a matter of fact. But you got to stay tuned. Either if you're there, you'll hear it. If not, Monday, you'll hear all the major announcements. This, I want you to be a part of. I want you to be there with me.
Okay.
1982. No, not the year we're born. Oh. 1982, it's a panel called Celebrating the Geekiest Year Ever. 1982 was the year we got Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, Return of the Jedi, Blade Runner, What else did we get? But a whole bunch of things, movies, TV shows, and a lot. That was the year that really, if you were a geek.
Well, I wasn't alive.
You were beat up. Because back then it wasn't as cool or as accepted as it is now. But we're going to celebrate that year now that it is. And no one's going to beat us up. And you weren't alive.
I was not alive then.
I mean, you weren't born.
I was not born, well, that's not what alive. That means. Hello.
Yeah, so that's neither the reason the why. Yeah, that's the reason why I want you there so you can see what the
experience
heck is
your
all
1982.
This. Yeah, what the heck is all this stuff that we're talking about on this show? Amazing Spider-Man, of course, I'm going to be there for that. Not for the reboot, for the actual comic book. Marvel Comics will have a panel on the Amazing Spider-Man. Saturday is always the biggest day. Uh-huh. And no difference here in Anaheim. We're going to start with Doug Neff, of course.
Yes.
Or you'll hit me if we don't. But I told you, and you made a face like you wanted to steal my Cheerios anyway.
Uh-huh.
I told you before we started the show today, I'm actually going to leave you in the panel and have to go away for a little bit during the panel.
You'll just have to go.
Not because I don't like Doug Neff, but because I get to talk to Ralph Bakshi.
Oh, really?
Yes, him. All of you out there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Wizards, remember that movie? Celebrating 35 years. He also did, speaking of Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, the cartoon versions, mm-hmm. the ones with a lot of singing. No, I'm not going to sing. I've done it before. Not this time. Yeah, well, maybe, because you're new. You didn't hear me last. Nah, I'm not going to sing. How do
you
want
should think
to
about it.
I did, and that's why I'm not singing. Also, what I'm really looking forward to is Prometheus. We're finally going to get the... I thought it was kind of funny, but it was there anyway. The teaser for the trailer that's coming. We got a teaser for a trailer.
They're teasing about the trailer.
Yes, but we get Prometheus, which is supposed to be not... officially, but it's supposed to be the Alien prequel.
Okay.
Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, looking forward to that. Gene DelVecchio was on part of the book club today. He was looking forward to that also. Also, of course, looking forward to Resident Evil Retribution.
Not surprised. You're totally going to be there.
It's going to be there, but you guys know how I am on this. Still on the fence, even though we're like, what, a few months away from release. The Amazing Spider-Man, still not sold on it. Maybe director Mark Webb and Emma Stone will be the ones to sell me on it. Maybe. Not. And hopefully they'll do a recreation of what happened at Comic-Con.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you've seen the YouTube on this. Last year at a Comic-Con, you'll see when you're in the big ballroom panel, they have a microphone on the stand and you can come up and ask, you know, whoever's up there questions. Like you would have liked it last year or a couple years ago. When Christopher Nolan was up there, you could have gone up to the microphone and asked him whatever you wanted. Last year during the Amazing Spider-Man panel, we had Mark Webb, Emma Stone, and a bunch of the actors up there. And there was a fan that came up in complete Spider-Man costume, mask and everything. And he started asking him questions, and then in the middle, he just took off his mask, and it was Andrew Garfield, surprise guest. So hopefully
I was just going to ask, was Andrew Garfield there?
Yeah, hopefully they'll recreate that, and we'll get to see him too. But again, they've got to sell me on this thing.
Was it the real costume?
No, it was just something that made like a fan, like a cosplay thing. That's
so funny.
Yeah, but you know, the crowd went crazy when they realized, sure, hey, it's Andrew Garfield.
Do you feel the same way about him?
So like I said, yeah, during the Doug Neff thing, I'll be stepping away for a little bit because I'll get to talk to Ralph Bakshi. It's pretty cool guy.
Okay.
It happens here. The Masquerade is going to happen in Anaheim, so we'll I'll take you to that. You can dress up if you want. Maybe not.
Hide my face.
Will Wheaton, I'm looking forward to talking to him. He'll just be there, and he'll also be part of one of the panels. But I want to talk to him not about his appearance on The Big Bang Theory, not about being Wesley Crusher on Star Trek. I want to talk to him about his experiences on my favoritist movie of all. Not Star Wars. He wasn't Luke Skywalker. He was Jordy LaChance. Stand By Me, my favorite movie. We'll talk about his memories on that. Max Brooks will be there. Ernest Cline will be there. Both of them, two good books. I'm still reading Ready Player One. Uh-huh. World War Z, I haven't picked it yet, but it's coming for the book club. And actually, we just got news a couple of days ago from our pals at Geek Tyrant. World War Z, the movie starring Brad Pitt,
yes,
been moved back to June 2013. June 21st, I think, 2013.
Did you say Brad Pitt's going to be in it?
Yes, he's the main character in this. He's not a zombie, but he's actually... you're not going to see a zombie Brad Pitt. Obviously, I want to be there for the Marvel panels, for the TV, and the Avengers versus X-Men thing. Going to say hi to Dino Andrade. He'll be there also. We had him on the show. And we'll say hello to the cosplayers. Mm-hmm. No, they're always there. So I'll have you take a camera and talk to them and see what they're all about. There's one actually who's here from the Bay Area. She may... I'm going to tease something that we're going to do. We're going to take a little break, by the way, because we're going to be exhausted, really. We're going to take a two-week break. We're going to do a spring break. Everybody else does, so why don't we do a spring break? We'll come back on April 4th. That show I'm planning, I don't know why we've never done this before.
Uh-huh.
Talking about cosplaying. What is it? Why is it? Why do you do it? How do you do it? We've talked to a lot of them at conventions and here on the show. We're going to have a couple of them. One's been on before, Rachel.
Mm-hmm.
She does more video game stuff, but she does the cosplaying thing too.
Uh-huh.
And one who's considered the icon of San Diego Comic-Con. Her name is Vampy. You know the website, vampybitme.com. Mm-hmm. You guys can go on there and check her out. She'll be at WonderCon. We might do some stuff with her there also. Planning on having them on. And also our guy, David Lee, who does the comics commentary, he cosplays at some of the conventions he goes to. He has some friends, so we'll have him. We'll have a whole bunch of cosplayers. You won't be able to see them unless we take pictures and put them on the website. But we'll talk about that. Nothing geekier than cosplaying at conventions or just at home. No, it's not weird when you do that. So your look says actually, yeah, it is. So okay, I'll take
I
your
know
word
people like cosplay a lot. It's they start like a year before the conventions.
And it's not October 31st, right?
No, for yeah. conventions.
Yeah, and Sunday. There's Alcatraz. Hurley's going to be there. And he'll never be known as anything else. He's going to be known as Hurley forever.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, Doc. Once upon a time, we had Raphael Sabarge not too long ago. I think your first show, we had Raphael Sabarge mm-hmm. on from Once Upon a Time. Rod's going to have his panel. We just heard from him a few minutes ago. He'll be there. I think that's it. Oh, there's one panel that I'm really looking forward to. That's what I'm waiting for on Sunday.
Uh-huh.
As long as, no matter what happens all weekend, as long as I get to talk to Josh Jackson,
uh-huh.
John Noble,
uh-huh.
Anna Torv is going to be there, but we get Lincoln Lee instead.
Yeah,
Blair
sure.
Blam will be there.
Okay.
That's all that matters.
Okay.
And actually, I'm going to have them talk to you.
About the show?
Yeah.
I've only seen, like, part of the first season.
You're going to get hate email, but I'll tell them anyway. You've said it before. You
not
hate.
Not a Fringe watcher.
No, you hate.
I hate it.
Fringe.
To be honest.
You abhor it. Hate's not strong enough.
Abhor.
Who are you calling the whore? No, but the Fringe panel, really, it's going to be on Sunday. We're really looking forward to that. Alcatraz, we'll be there, but I've told you guys many times, it's lost me. It's, convict of the week and not
yep.
really going anywhere. So that's it. That's what we're looking for. Before we go anywhere else, thank you. Let's thank everybody. Your favorite.
Thank you.
Doug Neff. Justin Berger, director, producer, help him alive. They'll be there. Everybody will be there. Jeph Loeb, Scott Marcano, Mr. Diablo, Rod Roddenberry, Emily Robertson from the Star Wars Where Science Meets Imagination exhibit. Remember, that's not part of WonderCon. It will be happening until April 15th, and it's literally about 10 minutes away from the convention center. So when you guys want to take a little break, no better place to relax than sitting in the cockpit of the Millennium Falcon.
I know, right? That sounds like fun.
And you were asking, actually, when we took the break, are we going to go there? If we do, really, who do you want to be? Chewie? Han Solo?
Oh my gosh. Are we back to this again?
Yeah. Okay, we'll talk about it on the road trip down there.
I'll just sit there by myself, and then I'll enjoy it for 10 minutes. You can have it another 10
minutes. Well, what fun is that? Because when the hyperdrive doesn't work, who are you going to blame? Nobody but you. So that'll happen this weekend. Again, go to geekspeakshow.com. Look for our Twitter coverage. What do you call that?
When you tweet?
Yeah, that. Just look at our Twitter. You follow us on there. We'll live tweet from all the panels. We'll send you some pictures. We'll send pictures of Violet with her mouth open. Like, he's here? I don't believe it. So you'll see her do that. And just follow us there. Our videos will be up on Monday. Not going to really bother with putting them up while we're there, because we're there. We're there for a reason. We're not there to put it up. But Monday, we're going to take a break, by the way.
Our spring break.
Yeah, our spring break. Everybody else is doing it, so we will too. We'll be back on April 4th, and like I said, I teased a little bit. I'm going to plan it during the break. I want to talk cosplay, because we've talked to many of them on here before,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know why we've never done this kind of show where we just talk about it.
It's about time.
Cosplay, because a lot of opportunities are coming up for Free Comic Book Day, Comic-Con. I've seen some people do it. They do it for the midnight showings for the Avengers and
yep.
other movies. So all those opportunities are coming up. And if you need a little push, you're sitting there at home thinking, I don't know if I want to go dressed up. We'll talk to some people who will give you that final push and show you how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Rachel, she was on with us actually on the first show this season. She does more video game stuff, but she cosplays also. She'll talk to you. Our own David Lee does a comics commentary. You didn't hear
mm-hmm.
him today, but he's ready for to talk cosplay. He'll bring some friends who cosplay with him. We'll talk about that. Also, we'll talk to another new friend of mine. She's known as the icon of San Diego Comic-Con. She does a lot of cosplaying. Her name is Vampy. She lives here in the Bay Area. She may either come in here or on the phone,
mm-hmm.
but we'll have her talk about all about cosplaying because hers are phenomenal, her costumes. So we'll do that when we come back. Till then, oh, don't forget also pknradio.com, our new home. Yeah, we're not married or anything, but our new home, pknradio.com. Every Thursday morning, you guys can hear these episodes, the brand new episodes on there. They'll still be up on the geekspeakshow.com website. You can download them there. But if you want to hear them fresh, and how you guys listen to music all the time, now you have something else to listen to when you get tired of the same noise over and over. Go to this stuff and you'll get our noise over and over and over.
They'll wake up to us.
So every Thursday at 8 a.m. Pacific time, 11 a.m. Eastern time, and 10 in the middle of the country, you can hear whatever show we recorded that week. The new show will be on there. And we'll replay again at midnight and also at 9 p.m. our time here, Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pknradio.com. It's up on our, the link is up on our homepage. So bookmark it. That's where we'll be. Where we'll be this weekend, WonderCon, you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
I'm not packed, so I'm going to go pack and then we will go. So we'll see you. Well, you'll see us actually this weekend. Everybody say bye.
See ya.
Bye.
The Geek Speak Show.